It's after 6 a.m. Good morning, everybody. My name is Nachum Siegel. Welcome to a Wednesday. This is your Jewish Moments in the Morning radio program, and we are recording the first hour of our Wednesday morning broadcast from the nighttime events in advance of Bike for Chai. We are here in Connecticut. The final 2 hours of our program this morning will be from the start line very, very early on Wednesday morning. But tonight, on Tuesday night, we are doing our 6 a.m. hour to meet some guests, get some people on the air, and talk about this amazing cause. You can go to bikeforchai.com. As of now, meaning as we're recording this, there are just over $6.5 million, which is pretty amazing. And you can go to bikeforchai, the number 4chai.com, to make your contribution. Last year at this time, I was joined by Mark Zomik. Mark looks very different now. This is Miriam Wallach in the role of producer and co-host of the broadcast. Welcome to Bike for Chai.
Thank you.
Good morning. You chose the right time to show up.
I sure did.
We are here at the best time to be at Bike for Chai. Should I tell you?
Because the pasta party.
Correct. Very good.
Thank you very much.
It is the pasta party. And what could be better than being here for the big pasta celebration in advance of the big ride tomorrow morning? Because the ride tomorrow morning, I mean, we'll have guests, but they'll be a little bit bleary-eyed. It'll be very early. You know, the start is smooth.
Even for JM and the AM time.
Correct.
It's early.
It is going to be early. The start is smooth, but, you know, it's early in the morning and people can be a little groggy. You know how it is. So tonight, the big pasta party celebration is the place to be, that's for sure.
Yeah. And
we'll meet some of the people that are riding and why they're so dedicated and how they've got hundreds of riders and why over $6.5 million has already been raised and why this is such an unbelievable cause. One that's familiar, unfortunately, to the Jewish community, very familiar in Chai Lifeline and Camp Simcha, but one that just has such an incredible ripple effect throughout the community with the work that it does. I want to this is always dangerous to mention names, but right off the bat, some people who I haven't seen in so long.
Right, so then let's start mentioning
names. Have stopped by. First of all, NFL great Alan Weingrad is here.
Yes.
So he's riding.
It was standing next to the two of you that was made me feel pretty short.
Well, he's a big guy. Cantor Yitzi Spinner was here on the World of Jewish Music. Yitzi Spinner was here from the Hebrew Institute of White Plains just moments ago. Dr. Ari Ginsberg, and I told the staff that he'd be bolting by from Beit Shemesh, and he'd be joining us at some point. He'll likely say hi tomorrow morning with us. Haskell Bennett, very well-known community leader and activist, was here.
Avi
Kaplan. And many, many others. Zelig Mandel is here with the Passaic, I assume the Passaic Clifton entourage.
And Avi Kaplowitz, who's basically our shadchan.
Correct. Avi Kaplowitz, whose idea it was for us to really tag along with Bike for Chai as much as possible. And
we drive.
Yeah, tag along.
Right, okay.
And for us, what that means is that we'll be here for the big party and the advanced celebration.
Right.
That we're willing to do.
And then we wave goodbye.
Not only that, we're also willing to be at the finish line and give an eyewitness account that, in fact, it is the world's greatest finish line. But the stuff in between, which I'm told requires 180 miles of cycling.
And training.
That we have not, I would assume plenty of training, that we have not yet gone ahead and made a commitment for.
We will make a commitment to join them at the pasta party.
Correct.
Yes. And we will make a commitment to eat as many snacks in the periphery as possible. But it's just the cycling up.
That seems to be the problem.
That's where we draw the line.
When that happens, when you have found out that Nachum Segal is cycling with Bike for Chai, then that's it. Then they can already say, wow, this is a great success, even greater than we ever anticipated.
I offered Alan Weingrad, by the way, to pick him up halfway through, take him to Starbucks, and then just, you know, move on.
He's an NFL great.
I know.
He's not a cheater. He's not going to do that, and certainly not with a charity involved.
That's what I would do.
That's what you would do. All right, now we know who we're talking to, at least. We're at the Crown Plaza. A big, big compliment to this hotel, which has great leadership and wonderful staff, for doing such a great... I'm laughing because everyone knows that one of my cousins is a staff member here. But they have done a remarkable job, and we thank them. And Jamie Turkel is sitting our first guest. We're actually going to be joined here by some of the people who are, I assume, riding. I assume all of them are going to be riding at some point. Am I right? Miriam L. Wallach is playing a role in seating our guests, and I thank her. And we have microphones and everything. Imagine that. It's like a real radio team. Alan Shama is here. Where's Alan?
Right here.
Shalom, shalom. Welcome to JM and the AM.
Thank you. Welcome. Great to be here.
Do we have Jay Eisenstadt here?
Yes, right here.
Jay, how are you?
Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you, sir. And Morty Husarski, are you here?
I am here.
Morty, nice to see you.
Good to see you again as well.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, am I right that the three of you are riding, are participating in the big ride?
Yes, that's we correct. Are.
Alan is riding since 2010. Boy, you've put in a lot of good years and a lot of good effort for the children and the people that are helped by High Lifeline and Camp Simcha. Bike for High only started in 2010. For people who think that it got to this point because and it got to this gargantuan size because it's been in existence for 20, 30 years, it's only 6 years or so that it's actually been around. And you're a founding member of one of the more interesting teams, and that's Team Cyclist with an S-Y right at the beginning. Now, I saw on the web that this team is doing very well fundraising-wise and that you guys deserve special commendation. Explain to our audience Team Cyclist and what they're all about.
Basically, it's a group of Sephardic Jews from the Deal, in the southern Deal area. We've been riding since 2010, and we picked up steam and got a lot of our friends and families to join this wonderful event. So this year, we decided to come together as one unit and really go ahead and really turn it on, and they really raised from $18 to $10,000 and raised thousands of dollars for this unbelievable organization.
Well, we were told you're a member of the Triple High Club, and they even be higher than that at this point. Who knows, as people continue to contribute. Yes. How many members are there of Team
Cyclists? About 20 members, 20 cyclists.
Is that going to grow? You think even more people are going to join soon?
Next year we'll have probably a lot more, yes.
Unbelievable.
This is picking up steam. Every year we do more and more. Everybody wants to be part of it. We actually have a wait list for the whole ride, so we'll get as many as we can to register early to make sure that they're part of the wonderful event.
One of the things about High Lifeline, obviously, is that every angle, every aspect of the community is familiar with their work. Every section of the community, I should say, is unfortunately familiar with their work.
And this organization is always there for them. They support them on every single level. It's devastating that the families have to go through, and they're there to make them comfortable and to give them the support and the guidance, and we all recognize that. And the people have been, the families that we are involved with know this firsthand or from other friends and relatives. They know how important High Lifeline is when, God forbid, you're struck with this terrible disease.
So we are saluting the Sparta community and
that's
Team
correct.
Cyclists.
There you go.
There you
Thank
go
you.
Is right. Good luck
Thank
with
you.
The with the ride. I'm
Thank
sure
you so
it'll
much.
Go very well. Jay Eisenstadt is riding for the fifth time. My God, you're a real veteran. A member of the Double High Club, which again is a nice distinction to say the least.
They
call you one of the earliest riders. So when you first rode, how many riders were there with you?
I started, I think, on the second year, maybe at 100 riders the second year.
Was that from here or left from somewhere
no,
in Jersey?
No, somewhere else. I don't even remember where anymore at this point.
Was it from Deal?
From Asbury Park, right?
And how different is it now that there are hundreds more with you?
I thought it would be less individualistic, but truth is, in the end, I feel like a big family. 500 riders, I thought it would be overwhelming, but they really give unbelievable attention to each person. As you can see, every detail is thought of, and I thought it would be overwhelming because I started with 100, now up to 500. I've seen that transition, and the truth is, it's just as great as it was before.
What's the fundraising like compared to year two?
Well, it's hard because everybody's cannibalizing each other. We all know each other. We all on the same community almost, so it's been more difficult, but you know what? We've over 6.5.
Yeah, over 6.5.
So the Siyata Shmaya is still there. It's quite amazing.
And was it an easy sell even back then? Because today it seems people just want to open up their pockets and give whatever they can for this event.
Unfortunately, it's a universal cause. So the sell is not the hard part. It's finding somebody that cares and hasn't donated to somebody else on his table is the difficult part.
Right, exactly. And we have Morty Husarski's here. He's a member of the 100K Club. Congratulations on
Thank that. You. Just to give you an idea, there's 24,000 donations that make up that $6.5 million.
24,000. From big to small and everything in between.
Exactly.
A member of Team TFSB, also one of the earliest riders. Morty, what is TFSB?
The Federal Savings Bank.
Oh, very nice. How did they get involved? Did you bring this concept to them?
I work for the bank, right. Executive Vice President, and I've been cycling for many years. And when the opportunity to get involved in a Bike for High back in 2010 and 2011, I got involved and 2012 became one of the first corporate sponsors, and snowballed from there. Now we have a team, 8 riders, cumulatively raised well over 150 grand, and you know,
unbelievable. How many riders you said?
8.
8 riders are raising that kind of money. It's fantastic. And what area are you from? Where are you? What neighborhood are you from?
Flatbush.
From Flatbush, Brooklyn. So there are plenty of people familiar with the great work of Chi Lifeline, and you're able to fundraise and get them involved.
Well, I was personally a recipient of Chi Lifeline's goodness over the years for a variety of different reasons, and the work they do is incredible, and this is just a way to give back.
What is it like when they hold your hand to get you through a process?
It's indescribable. I remember the first time when we were in the hospital, and I didn't reach out to anybody at Chi Lifeline. I didn't know anybody at Chi Lifeline. And all of a sudden, they're just there. And they're like, whatever you need, whether it's tutoring for the child at home, games, meals, whatever it is, they're just there. And today we give back in many ways. My wife is a volunteer to cook for Chi Lifeline Yom Tov in Flatbush. She cooks 6 times whatever we do for Yom Tov to be able to give out to families that are in need. And it's indescribable the amount of love and caring that this organization gives. And if this is a way that I can give back by just going out there and pushing 180 miles and raising whatever I could, that's what we do.
Final question for the three of you. This portion of the show is going to be airing in the 6 a.m. hour in the morning. Is the 6 o'clock hour in the few minutes before the ride begins exhilarating for you? Is it nerve-wracking? Are you worried about stuff, about what the next 180 miles will bring? How would you describe what it's like those minutes before?
I want to go first on this one, because last year in the few minutes before the ride, you interviewed me. So that took up a lot of my time that I needed to be able to get. So I like this slot a little bit better.
Well said. Point well taken.
I think it's quite, it's very, you're very anxious to get on the road and to start the trek for the 180 miles and go up, you're 7,000 feet. It may not, you really don't understand how high that actually is to climb for the first day. So I think in my case, it's, you're anxious.
I'll explain. 7,000 feet, Hunter Mountain Ski Resort is about 2,400 feet. So it's about 3 times going up Hunter Mountain. So that's just the people who ski, know that's pretty high. It's exhilarating in the morning. It's really a special moment, and it really leads up for 6 months of training and fundraising. And it brings your emotions out. It's not just 6 in the morning. It's 6 in the morning every morning for the last 6 months.
All right.
That we really schedule our day so we can ride and raise money and prepare for this ride. So the emotions are just overwhelming. It's not specific to that morning.
I want to thank for helping us kick off this special edition of JM and the AM, Alan Shama, Jay Eisenstadt, and Morty Husarski. Thank you, gentlemen. Good luck.
You, Nachum. Thank
good
you.
Luck.
Thank you.
Oh,
good
yes.
To see you.
There you go. They are ready. They are ready for the big race. Lee Moss is joining me here at JM and the AM. Lee, according to our notes, is riding for the very first time.
That's correct.
Comes from Baltimore, Maryland.
No, actually, La Plata, Maryland.
Well, why do they tell me Baltimore?
Because I rode with the guys from Baltimore about 3 weeks ago, and they claimed me as their elder statesman.
And how does one become an elder statesman? Are you of a certain age group that... I'm so curious to ask you your age and can't figure out if it's a polite thing to do on the air or not.
Yeah.
But let's just say you're one of the elder statesmen.
That's what they tell me.
Ruben Bendelstein is here as well. He's a member of Team Yehuda, riding for the 3rd time, member of the Chi Club, a club we continue to laud. And he does live in Baltimore, am I right?
I actually live in the 5 towns.
There you go.
5 towns representing.
So we've got
0 for 2.
We've got our, well, I would say the people who prepared my notes are 0 for 2.
There you go.
All right, what got you involved, Lee, that you wanted to finally do this? How does one get to the point, especially, excuse the expression, at your age, to say I'm doing this for the first time?
Yeah, so, well, I've been riding now for about 6 years,
mm-hmm.
and always looking for an interesting challenge. And my nephew rode last year, and we've kind of connected each other through cycling, and... I decided I wanted to take on this challenge because, number one, from a physical perspective, great physical challenge. But number two, and even more important, is what a worthwhile organization. And it really is thrilling and exciting to be able to participate in something like this. And, you go out and you do the fundraising and it becomes really infectious.
Right. I can only imagine. Have you done the 180 in practice, or it doesn't work that way?
No.
Not even close,
no,
right?
No, no, No.
So does this worry you as you start thinking about the start line in the morning?
No. I'll get there.
You'll get there somehow.
Yeah. One way or another, I'm going to get there. It's, you know, everybody says it's not a race, it's a ride, right? But they put a number on you, so maybe it is a race. You know.
It's a ride until everybody decides to compete during the last mile.
Yeah. But
then it's different.
But, you know, I mean, most of the challenge is up here.
Understood.
Yep.
All in the head.
Yep.
Ruben, tell me about Team Yehuda.
Well, you know, Team Yehuda, last year my coworkers and I had a Team Shatrit, and this year we were thinking, you know, my coworker Abe Gdansky said to us, you know, he has a friend out in Chicago that is a very good close friend of his, said his son was diagnosed with a muscular dystrophy. And, you know, we wanted to do something special. So I'm like, you know what? It is Team Shatrit, but, you know, we want to do Team Yehuda, dedicate our whole team, our whole corporate team to him. And so I remember I said, you know, our logo actually is Darth Vader. And I said, it all came about because I said to him, you know, ask your friend what Yehuda's favorite thing is. He says, Star Wars. Star Wars is his number one. So, you know what? We Star Wars, and I'm like, great. So we'll put Yoda, we'll put Chewbacca, who we're doing. Darth Vader.
Darth Vader's
number one. So I'm like, listen, Darth Vader, Yehuda calls a shot. So listen, he's an inspiration. He doesn't let his illness slow him down. And hopefully we're not going to let the hills slow us down. And we'll finish the 180 miles for him.
So he's quite aware of what you're doing, obviously.
Absolutely.
And I assume this gives a tremendous boost of enthusiasm to the people around him because, you know, it's not easy, obviously, the situation.
Not at all.
And this must give them, a tremendous boost.
It gives him a tremendous boost, but, you know, his family and his friends say, you know, nothing slows the kid down, and he's truly an inspiration to us. So I don't think anything's more fitting for us than to do a team that's totally dedicated to him.
Understood.
So,
all right, congratulations. Ruben's a member of the High Club and is getting ready for the big ride tomorrow morning.
That's right.
A lot of anticipation, I'm sure. A lot of training as well, right?
Lots of training, a lot of waking up at 4 a.m., believe it or not.
Well, I believe that.
You could ask any of these guys, like, what would you wake up 4 a.m. for? Do this, that, and another? These guys wake up 4 a.m. It's not just me. Ask anybody. These guys wake up very early, very dedicated. I'm sure you're waking up early as well.
Sometimes it's 4 a.m. just to go down in the basement and ride on the trainer.
Ride on the trainer. Yeah, listen, it's tough. It all comes down to this is, for us, the pinnacle. So.
And Lee Moss. Lee is one of the elder statesmen, as he proclaimed.
That's what they tell me.
All right. Hey, the label has stuck. What can I tell you? And good luck tomorrow.
Thank you very much.
I'm sure it's going to be an interesting 2 days.
I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, more coming up. We are on a JM in the AM special here with our friends at High Lifeline and Camp Simcha as we continue this amazing adventure called Bike for High. You can go ahead and you can give and be generous and support the amazing effort here. All you got to do is go to the website, bikeforhigh.com. That's bikeforhigh.com. And when you go there, you'll be able to dedicate your dollars to a specific rider, a specific team, specific part of the cause, whatever it is you wish. And you'll have the unbelievable distinction to support. Hey, Cousin Michael. Hey, Tova's here. Tova Feldstein is here. She gets a special shout-out from Cousin Nachum. How do you like that? You have an opportunity to join what over 24,000 people have done already, and that is contributing to High Lifeline and Camp Simcha. All right, we'll go to this selection. More coming up if you keep it right here on a JM in the AM Wednesday morning. Reminder, tomorrow, live performance in our studio from Keepa Live, an a cappella group, Keepa Live, tomorrow morning at JM in the AM. Oh, yo.
along. Ho, ay, 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 diddy-dum. Diddy-diddy-di-di, diddy-diddy-dum. Oh, yo, hang, diddy-dum. Diddy-diddy-di-di-di-lam. Oh, yo, yo.
In the AM, it is a Wednesday morning broadcast, and we are here in hour number one on a Tuesday night right outside the pasta party, one of the most important events connected to Mike Frechai. Shmuley Abramson is with us. Shmuley Abramson was a Chai Lifeline client. He is a former Camp Simcha camper. He is riding now for the fourth time. Welcome to JM in the AM.
Thank you so much for having me.
A pleasure to speak with you. Can you do a little bit of his history with us? It goes back to you were how old as a Chai Lifeline patient or client?
Well, I was diagnosed actually on 9/11/01 with a brain tumor. So that was a little different day than...
You were diagnosed, on 9/11, on the 9/11,
correct,
with a brain tumor. You were at the doctor earlier, and this was the day
that
they...
Yes, I went to the hospital, right, and they took tests, and that's when they told me that I had a brain tumor, a medulloblastoma. So it was a little different day than for most.
Yeah,
than
that's
others.
For sure. Where were you living at the time?
I was in Baltimore. I live in Baltimore, so I was in Johns Hopkins. So, yeah. So I had.
Can I ask how old you were when this happened?
Oh, sure. I was 13, almost 14.
Okay, so you just passed bar mitzvah.
Yes.
You find this out.
Yes.
And now what happens?
It sounds a little funny, but I was like, actually, like, I wasn't sad or anything. I was like, oh, cool. I have like a brain tumor. That's, I got attention. But
for a few hours, it's a cool thing.
Hours, huh? Yeah. I guess I really didn't know what that meant. Like, you know, so they explained to me, I ended up having two surgeries on 9/21 and then 9/23.
Right away?
Yeah. And then I had to go through 6 weeks of radiation and then 48 weeks of chemotherapy.
Wow.
So.
It's almost a year of chemotherapy.
Yeah.
Since then?
Since then, thank God I'm okay. I feel great. I have a wife, two kids.
Wow. What's it like being a camper at Camp Simchas?
You really can't explain it. I mean, you totally forget about everything.
I mean, you'll see campers on Thursday, and this whole experience will be something that it's so rare that someone is riding and has been through this experience.
Yeah, it's
so really, you know what's going through their minds and how they're living their days.
Yeah, it's like surreal. It's like I can imagine. I know what they're going through, and to really ride all those miles and really have that in your mind, knowing that I'm riding every mile, fighting every hill to, you know, for those kids. It's
Oh, that I can imagine. But from the kids' standpoint, as they go through the couple of weeks experience of being a camper, we always hear how the programming at the camp, how the experiences and special projects that they have in the camp, whether it's music or otherwise, I don't know if it distracts the kids or enhances their lives to the point where they're able to continue to live with what they have. How would you describe, from the camper's standpoint, what that experience at Camp Simcha does?
Yeah, I mean, you totally forget about whatever's going on. You have an amazing, amazing, amazing time. For example, like I lost so much weight, I got down to 99 pounds when I was sick. So I ended up having to have an NG tube, goes through your nose down to your stomach to be fed. And that would come out, it would come out of my nose like almost every day, just because being nauseous, smelling things, and it would just come out, and then I have to feed it back in, put it down. Really, really
Not fun,
exactly. So when I was getting ready for camp, my father, my parents, we packed up all our extra tubes, because it happens every day. I'll have to put in a new one and whatever. Not once in camp did I ever happen to put in a new NG tube. I just I totally forgot about everything that's going on. Just having a blast. My counselors was amazing. It's just, you get anything that you want, food, entertainment, everything. It's It's amazing.
Yeah, some youngster who once visited there once said to me, you know, if you press the button on the soda machine, soda just comes out for free.
Yeah.
So, well, you know, there's a price to pay for that, though.
Yeah, unfortunately. But.
Unfortunately is right. Speaking with Shmuley Abramson, so now, at what point did you decide to start this riding thing?
Well, actually, my older brother, Eliyahu, he started it. He was, I think it was the second or third year that Bike Brachai was established. So he rode it. So this will be his sixth time riding, his sixth year riding. I saw him do it like a year after that. My other brother, Eliezer, he did it the next year. And I really, like, when I was sick, I lost all my strength, never really gained it back. And I was like, I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this. I just don't have the strength, like, just like anyone else.
Well, what would doctors tell you? Would they tell you that you're not, I don't know, it's not a good idea or you're not fit for it? Like,
no.
What would they say to you?
No, they, I mean,
they'd say, go for it.
At that point, I mean, it was a number of years after. So at that point, I was, you know, on my own, really, at that point. But I just didn't have the strength. That's what I thought. But they convinced me, and I was convinced to do it, and I really wanted to fight for those, to really do that, the ride.
So you ever see any of the counselors that were your counselors back then?
Sure, I still keep in touch with some of them. They're not still in the camp, but...
No, that I understand. I just wonder if they understand the role they've had in so many children's lives, if they understand, you know, how much joy and how much distraction and how much energy they're giving to, you know, to kids who normally outside of camp wouldn't have it.
Yeah, they know. They see the fruit of their labor. You know, we keep in touch. You know, they see, you know, thank God I'm married, I have kids, you know. You know, and then I happened to be, I was actually a staff member as well after three years being as a camper.
So you must look at the other staff members and say, you guys don't know what this is all about. I know what this is all about.
Yes.
Can come in handy, huh?
Yeah.
Having a background
for sure.
Knowing
history, you can connect with the kids a little bit differently than most other counselors, staff members. So
I can only imagine. Unbelievable. So good luck. Good luck. You'll be on the starting line at 7 a.m. Eastern time.
7 a.m. This will be my fourth year.
Fourth year already.
Fourth year.
Does it get easier each year?
It does.
A lot more fun each year?
A lot more fun. You don't have to be as nervous. You know, my first year I was nervous. I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this, but I, you know, fought through, and every year it just gets easier and easier.
Unbelievable.
You know, you train, and so.
Shmuley Abramson, a pleasure to meet you. A High Lifeline client one time, just at the age of 13, a former Camp Simcha camper, a former Camp Simcha counselor, and now riding for the fourth time in the morning for Bike for Chai. And people can go to the website and sponsor you and your ride.
Bikeforchai.com/SA.
There you go. Bikeforchai.com/SA. Thanks so much for joining me today.
Thank you so much.
Wow, that's a pretty amazing conversation, I must say. Who has the privilege of following that one? That's what I want to know. Gentleman's name is Alan Lieberman. Alan Lieberman is with us, a member of Team Meridian. Oh, boy. All right, we should have a special fanfare for Team Meridian, frankly.
Oh, we did a great job this year, Nahum.
A great job. We've been acknowledging you guys for weeks. It's unbelievable what's going on with this team.
Thank you very much. Last year, we had an interview.
Well-deserved.
We were looking at about the 800 mark
right.
as a potential,
right.
but we took it full gear this year around.
I hate to interrupt before you say the magic number, but I think during that conversation, we actually toyed with a seven-figure number. Would it ever be able to be achieved? Would it ever be able to, you know, that your team would be able to accomplish it? Now, for those who know, and for us, it's only Tuesday night, so that number is going to grow. But for those of us who know, that number is, in fact,
$1 million.
Right, over $1 million.
Correct.
Which is unbelievable.
Well, that was a goal, and I give credit to our chairman and CEO, Ralph Hertzka, and his staff, his marketing department, his assistants. I mean, it's a concerted effort that he coordinates, and a tremendous, tremendous achievement and accomplishment.
And would it be accurate to say, and as an observer of the Jewish community, I think it is, but you can confirm, that this is not the only cause that Team Meridian takes up?
That's true.
There are many things that happen through the Meridian office. This one obviously seems to be a real pet project of the entire staff.
And it's important. There are other projects. However, Ralph took up cycling about a year after I started. And this is going now 5 years, and that has become a passion that we are looking to become also fit. You know, as we're progressing in our age, as we're progressing in our careers, yeah, we want to create a more fit lifestyle, and this is giving us that opportunity to do so, while at the same time, you know, giving back to the community.
now when someone's hired at Meridian, do they get a bicycle with the Meridian
label
on it?
That's very funny. I think you have to work there a couple of years.
But I can see it.
But we buy our own bikes.
Oh, yeah. No, no imprinted Meridian bicycles, huh? Alan Lieberman is a member of Team Meridian. It is the top team in fundraising. As you heard, he's been riding since 2011, a member of the Chai Club, a club that we continue to announce with great distinction. And what can I say? I mean, well-deserved. Team
thank
Meridian,
you,
we salute. Like
much.
I say, they need a special fanfare. There you go.
Hey, I want
a special fanfare for Team Meridian.
Listen, I want to give a shout-out to also my crew from Long Island, the Five Towns Riders.
Yeah.
We've been a group now going on for 6 years since the very beginning.
Nice.
So we started with five from the Five Towns, and now we have over 50.
Wow, amazing.
All right, so kudos to the crew.
Amazing. You're excited about the morning?
Absolutely.
Does Team Meridian get at the very start of the start line, I hope?
I think we typically do.
I hope so. Well deserved, let me tell you.
If we finish at the start is also another question, but we'll see what happens.
No, I have a feeling you'll do great. Alan Lieberman, I thank you. Johnny Zouder is with us. He is one of the older cyclists, I am told, and he's there for the...
So
I'm sorry?
That doesn't sound so good.
It doesn't sound good. I think it's amazing. Are you kidding? Nonetheless, whether it's good or not, it's a fact, and I welcome you to JMVAM.
Thank you.
Where are you from?
That's a long story. Originally, I was born in Belgium.
Yeah.
I was raised in Uruguay, South America.
Wow.
I went to Yeshiva in Baltimore and Israel. Then my parents moved to Eretz Israel in the meantime. Then I moved to Eretz Israel for a few years. And in Baltimore, my roommate was from Los Angeles, so I decided to visit him, and I came for a couple of Pesachs. And I liked it a lot. So at the end, I decided, okay, no, Israel's a little bit difficult, so I'm going to go back to the States, so I went to Los Angeles.
And are you in Los Angeles now?
I live in Los Angeles, yeah.
Are there other LA riders that are joining?
Yeah, sure.
There are plenty of people
that
have come in.
There's about 14 or 15 of us, yeah.
Yeah, I saw license plates in the parking lot from all these different states and people driving in and flying in from all the different locations. How did you get involved with High Lifeline? How did you even know that this event exists?
Well, I started biking about 5 years ago, and a couple of the friends from LA, you know, some of the youngsters, they were already biking for a while, and they were doing the Lake Tahoe bike for Chai, the ride. And they convinced me to join them, and I said, great. I mean, it's a great cause, obviously.
Oh, yes.
And unfortunately, about a month before that happened, I had an accident, and I wasn't able to bike on that one. So next year, they said, okay, let's go higher next year. Let's go to New York and do the bike for Chai here. And that's it. It's my third year in a row.
How does the Zouderer bicycle get to New York?
It gets to New York on a bike bag that we purchased a few years ago. My son also bikes here, and my son-in-law bikes with us.
And it's the bikes sit in those bags on the plane?
They sit on the plane. They get checked in. They charge you $150 each way. Not cheap, but they go nice and comfortable. They get it in one piece, and that's
what. Are you happy with the bicycle?
I'm very happy with it, yes.
So far, so good.
I'm very happy, yeah.
Do you constantly have to upgrade your bicycle and equipment?
Not constantly. I did a few upgrades, but for the time being, I'm fine with it.
I wonder if you have a big advantage being from L.A. where the weather's always so good compared to people here who have to deal with the rain and snow.
I certainly think we do. We have, most of the year, we have very good weather, and we're spoiled. Like myself, well, I'm a little older, so if it rains a little bit, I don't bike that much. And if it's too hot, I don't bike either, so...
A spoiled West Coast guy,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah.
Well, there goes somebody's bicycle behind us. Well, congratulations. I'm sure you're excited
Thank
about
you.
The morning.
I'm super excited, yes.
A lot super of anxiety excited. Or a lot of energy? What is
no,
it?
No, I get a few little butterflies here and there. And I had a fall last week, but thankfully it's fine. So
should be a great ride, huh?
Yeah.
Pleasure meeting you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us. Johnny Zouderer from Los Angeles, California. We are told he's one of the older cyclists here, and if you want to support Bike for Chai, you can go to the website, bike4chai.com. It's bike4chai.com. Avram Horenstein is with us.
Who are you?
Welcome to JM and the AM.
Thank you.
May I read some of the material we've been told about your biking situation?
Sure.
Ariella was a Chai Lifeline client who passed away several years ago. The Horensteins named Chai Lifeline's music program in her honor. I assume it's a program that goes on in camp? Or is this one that's year-round?
And
year-round.
In camp and in hospitals and at homes.
And that means a music program that where people come to sing music, or how does it work?
Everything that everything musicians you can imagine. Come to the children in the hospitals. There are musical events, musical therapy, and of course the music in, at camp.
Avram and his wife Devorah remained involved with High Lifeline as members, as mentors rather, for other bereaved parents. Devorah just finished medical school. I think we heard about this story. So yeah. It got some national attention, right?
Apparently.
Yeah. She finished medical school, a journey inspired by her experience as the mother of a medically compromised child. Avram, you're described as a cycling demon. How does one get to level of demon? At what point does that happen? And what do you need to do? How do you qualify for that?
Well, there was one time where I was 40 miles away from home and my seat cracked. And I biked 40 miles to the bike shop in order to get a new seat. I think that was probably the turning point.
That's where they dubbed you a demon.
I was in the Berkshire Mountains or something at the time.
So what can you tell us about this personal experience with High Lifeline? I mean, for those who have, thank God, not experienced it, what is it like having them hold your hand each and every day?
Well, certainly most people who, you know about Camp Simcha, and it's, you know, it's beautiful to see the children there, but what they don't realize is behind the scenes there are parents that are, you know, in the intensive care unit, and they're, you know, they're 24/7 looking after their kids. They're hungry. They don't necessarily need money. They just need, you know,
assistance.
Care. And so I think it's it's an amazing thing that they do that most people just don't even realize. And it's all year long. We spent a year and a half in Durham, North Carolina, where we were at Duke University Medical Center. We basically were there the entire time. I don't think we had 1 hour together without being with Ariella. And even there, High Lifeline from the Florida office were sending gifts, and they came out a few times. So they tracked us around from CHOP in Philadelphia to Duke. And then, you know, unfortunately, after a year and a half years, Ariella passed away. But, we, after the music program, you know, what we discovered, and I guess my wife discovered also, was that it's one thing to give money, and it's nice to do something in the honor of a child, but if you put yourself into it, and if you do something where, you know, you're physically doing it, whether you're cycling or whether you're it's a career, somehow it means more, and you feel it.
Often people will say the easiest thing to do is write a check, not to minimize the people who are writing checks.
Right,
it's wonderful. But we hear exactly what you're saying. Yeah. Ariella was a camper in camp or not?
No, she wasn't well enough to be in camp. She had an immune disorder, and so she got sick very easily. I was hoping at some point she'd be able to go, but that never happened. In fact, I didn't even know about Camp Simcha at the time we were being helped by High Lifeline. I just assumed that's what High Lifeline does.
Right, understood. So. Other parents, based on what we've been told, you speak to other parents and help them through these situations. What about other parents who ride in Bike for Chai? Are there others like yourself who are riders now?
There are some. I at some of the bereavement, we actually, as a group, some of the parents went to Camp Simcha during the off season, and I had mentioned that I was doing this, and I think a few of the parents do it, but. It's becoming a popular thing to do. The one interesting thing about the ride is that, you know, for all of the money that's raised and all that, it's amazing how much people are getting back. Not just because they feel great about what they're doing, but there are guys that have lost 100, 150 pounds. There are guys that have had high blood pressure. Even my doctor told me, he said he'd heard how much I was riding. He said, your cholesterol is way down. The test came back. My cholesterol is way down.
Right.
So, you know, cumulatively, all of these riders that are getting healthy, they're benefiting also.
Right. And their families will benefit in the long run.
Absolutely. And their children.
Earlier we spoke with somebody who was a camper at one point and therefore walks into camp with a completely different perspective, sort of a, you know, I know this place better than you guys do.
Right.
I was a staff member there as well. When you're a parent and doing this ride, I would assume thoughts are going through your mind that others are not thinking about during those 180 miles.
Yeah.
What would you call it? Emotional?
It's it's emotional, sure. You know, when biking is primarily about climbing because you've got ups and downs, but the downs go by pretty fast.
Right.
So you're pretty much most of the
time. The downs don't dominate, huh?
No. You're mostly climbing, and as I'm climbing, I'm thinking of the struggle, and you know that if you climb and you work at it and you grow from it. And it's the same way when you're taking care of a sick child, because, you know, on the surface, how could you possibly get through this? But you work and you struggle and, you know, you do what you can and you benefit from it and you get stronger. And that's it's a parallel.
Well, I think we get stronger from hearing from people like you.
Thank you.
I hope a lot of people responded to your plea and have helped you fundraise for the event.
Absolutely, they did.
And anybody who wants to look up Avram Horenstein on the website, they could sponsor you right now if they go to bikeforchai.com. Great. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
A pleasure. Yes. Meeting some amazing people as usual. Miriam L. Wallach is here.
You know, last year, I wasn't here. And Mark.
No, we were looking all over for you. Now yeah. I understand.
You weren't looking that hard because I wasn't here. Yeah. And Mark did a phenomenal job, and Jamie and the whole team did a. You know, the entire experience was.
Well, don't forget ZK.
Well, of course.
Because you're naming names.
I am naming names. Yeah. Enough Rummy, and you know anyone else who's
Mayor
potentially.
Kruder.
And you.
Is Mayor Kruder somewhere?
You were here. Anyway, yeah. I very much felt left out of the experience because everyone kept talking about it, how incredible
it's
it
like
was.
The whole Jewish world talks about it. It's amazing.
Right, but everyone was, I mean, this broadcast last year truly touched a tremendous amount of people. I know that it personally touched Jamie, and I get it. I completely get it. It's an unbelievably humbling experience, and you and I and this entire team have had numerous opportunities to be exposed and work with phenomenal organizations. But this is beyond phenomenal organizations because these are phenomenal individuals who are putting so much of themselves into what they're doing. And especially you have parents, you have family members. We met somebody before whose daughter is presently going through chemo who was riding.
I'm glad you used the word experiences because one of the things we've already discovered in the early part of this show is that riders have different things on their mind depending on their experiences as they're doing this. And I pinpointed to the person we were speaking to who was a staff member in camp.
Right.
That he, you know, walks into camp or rides into camp and has a completely different perspective. And but one of the things I wanted to mention to him actually, which I just didn't find the right I didn't think it was the appropriate time to do it, and I'm sure it'll come up at some point during this show. People like him meet plenty of people in Camp Simcha who are not around the following year.
Right.
And who are, you know, who are getting all this joy, energy, and excitement for what might be the last go-round for them, so to speak. And we haven't even spoken about that yet, you know, what that perspective is like. You know, counselors and staff members who encounter and deal with that type of situation.
Well, I was fascinated when you asked him about being in touch with former counselors.
Right.
And I was wondering whether you were going to ask him if he was in touch with co-campers.
Right.
And I very much appreciated the fact that you stopped at the water's edge almost to say, you know what, let's not.
Yeah, it wasn't for that one, but I'm sure it'll come up at some point. Okay, what are we doing?
Well, we're going to go to a song.
We'll go to a song. More coming up, everybody. Keep it right here at JM and the AM. It is a Wednesday morning broadcast, and we get an opportunity tomorrow on Thursday to have Keep Alive, the a cappella group, in our studio. They will be joining us at JM and the AM live in studio for a performance of a cappella selections. Here's Kol Ish at JM and the AM.
Gam ki Gates al lo irara ki ata imadi gam ki eilech begets al Shan
Techa. Hey Ma. Eliyahu hanavi lifne bo yom Hashem hagadol vehanora veheishiv levavot levavot albanim velev bo Shiv levavot, levavot al banim, velevanim al avotam. Nay, 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 nay,
get to close out the hour that we spend before the morning of the event of Bike for Chai with, of course, the leader of Chai Lifeline, and that is Rabbi Simcha Scholar. A pleasure to be with you again at Bike for Chai.
It's my pleasure to be with you, and it's really quite an exciting time here. You know, the thousands of people that are here, the thousands of people that are participating. It seems like Bike for Chai has become the premier event in the Jewish community. And it's really inspirational that so many people come out for Chai Lifeline.
You know, we were speaking off the air about the genesis of this entire ride, and it's, of course, when one gentleman wanted to get his bicycle to camp. You're obviously very familiar with the story. We've told it on the air.
Because he was supposed to get thrown out of camp because of that.
And instead, raised about $10,000. People sponsored him to go from Lakewood, I believe it was, all the way up to camp by bicycle. That's how the whole thing started. The concept began. And, you know, to talk about taking a negative or a somewhat of a setback and making such a positive out of it, and then tonight we meet, and during the show we meet people who have had the most drastically difficult circumstances with their own children or with themselves, and they have turned it into such an exhilarating experience, whether it being sponsoring something for Chai Lifeline and Kem Simcha that lives on forever, whether it's riding in this ride and raising a tremendous amount of money. Somebody who is actually a patient and a staff member at Camp Simcha is now here today ready to ride for the cause. It's just incredible what people do in the face of adversity.
I think that's really the the essence and the power of the Jewish people, to be able to take what is to be considered an adversity, an obstacle, and turn it into an opportunity. I mean, we're now in the 3 weeks, and of course there's a lot of obstacles that have happened to the Jewish people throughout time and immemorial. But the power of the galut, the power of the exile, is that we're able to take darkness and add some light to it. And I think that's what's happening over here. People are taking a sport, and it's a difficult sport, and they're turning it into something that's very holy, for a very holy cause. And they're not only doing it for themselves, but they're recruiting others to this mission. It's something very, very special.
It is amazing.
And it's really an altruistic mitzvah in its greatest sense. And you know, taking a sport which was normally associated with something that was not to be spiritual. Hanukkah was all about the Greek methodology of sport, and taking the sport and turning it around to something that's spiritual, I think that's a great thing.
It is incredible, and you're obviously familiar that tens of thousands of people are donating to the cause now each year just through Bike for Chai, aside from all the other great things you're doing. And thousands of them likely at some point, either now or through the archives, will hear this conversation. What do you say to a community that collectively has embraced this cause through this event the way they have?
I believe that Chai Lifeline is not an organization that belongs to an individual. It is a movement that belongs to the Jewish community. And everyone that participates in Chai Lifeline, in Bike for Chai, and in any aspect of Chai Lifeline, is really just participating in our work of taking care of these children that are affected by illness, both personally, physically, or if their parents are sick. But it's our families, it's our children, and it's our organization. It belongs to everyone until the Mashiach will come, when God willing, there'll be no reason
need
for it to exist anymore.
Someone mentioned earlier that when their child was in Durham, North Carolina, Chai Lifeline of Miami made sure to take care of them. Now, North Carolina and Miami are not exactly very close to each other geographically.
It depends what school you went to.
Yet they took the responsibility to do what they could for them hundreds of miles away.
Chai Lifeline has 13 regional offices throughout the world. And we basically cover all the major Jewish communities and the major treatment centers. Either we do it through our physical office in that region or through satellite offices or volunteers throughout. I mean, we deal with close to 5,000 families on a daily basis.
Wow.
So, we're basically centered in the mega Jewish communities, New York, Baltimore, Miami, Chicago, LA, Montreal, Toronto, Manchester, London, Antwerp, and in Israel, all over Israel. So, I mean, the camp actually has children from South America, from South Africa, from Australia.
And, of course, all over the U.S. and Canada.
All over the U.S. And it's really remarkable. It's to see the different types of participants. It's also remarkable to see the different types of volunteers and counselors that are in Camp Simcha. You know, in every camp, you have one type of counselor, one type of environment you all come from. In Camp Simcha, they're coming from all the different types of schools, all the different variations of the community, and it's a beautiful thing that they're able just to share a bunk and share a cause together.
It's America's one and only Jewish Moments in the Morning radio program, heard on listeners sponsored WFMU East Orange, WMFU Mount Hope, Rockland County at 91.9 on the FM dial, broadcasting with our mobile studio of the Sonia and Robert Gold Studios, normally from Jersey City, New Jersey. Around the world on the web, jmnam.org, and on the NSN app. You know, we spoke earlier of the different perspectives that people have when they get to camp. One of the reasons you're on so early each year, by the way, I should point out, is because you're so busy at Camp Simcha. It's impossible for you to join us when we're there, so you're here with us when we start this program on Tuesday night with all the cyclists and participants. And by the way, I hope the pasta party went well, because obviously that's one of the most important parts of the whole event, is the pasta party.
You obviously didn't eat for
it. I had some, but I just hope it collectively went well. One of the things we pointed out was all the different experiences people have. So somebody who was a patient and ended up being a staff member rides into Camp Simcha with obviously certain thoughts in mind. And those who unfortunately had children who fell victim to these diseases and decided to ride, they're riding into camp with certain thoughts in mind. When you see, as the director of Chai Lifeline now for 30 years, 25?
Almost 30 years.
When you see those riders come in on Thursday afternoon with the world's greatest finish line at that very, very special camp of Camp Simcha, what are your thoughts?
my first thought is incredible gratitude to God that has given us the opportunity to create such an event and be able to do such holy work for His children. And I try to always keep that in the front of my consciousness, because that's really the focus here. That's what we're all about. We're all about doing a mitzvah. We're all about doing something for Him up there. And I see on a very practical sense, I see an incredible organization of individuals and volunteers that have taken this logistical nightmare, in a sense, you know, and they've been able to work it out to its finest detail. I see the children being so elated by people coming and caring for them. I see this combination of organization and individual, and I see this energy. It's the energy that's there. I think, you know, you were there last year. The energy that's there is absolutely remarkable. It's there's only one word I can use for this. This is a Kiddush Hashem. This is sanctifying God's name, to see the community come together for the sake of a real purpose. It's something very special.
And it's amazing. Every neighborhood now. Every segment, we were speaking to Team Cyclists before, pointing out how every segment of the Jewish world is now involved, and they feel it's part of their community and that they're part of it. The volunteer effort is amazing, and your staff, I mean, I'm sure you go out of your way to hire the best people, but it's obvious from the way things are set up here, it's such a massive operation. You're dealing with really high qualified people who know what they're doing.
Besides their professional expertise, the quality of the High Lifeline professional is that they are all heart, and they give of themselves 125%. It's something special. You know, there's no such thing as day or night. They're always available. They're always on call. As we talk about this, what's going on right now, you have this magnanimous event here called Bike for Chai. You have Camp Simcha going on. You have the regular High Lifeline going on all over the world. There are emergencies happening. Kids are getting diagnosed. Emergencies are happening in different parts of the world. They're handling it all. Because it's all about doing what we're doing the best way we can for the individual.
And one of the things we should point out, we said this last year when you were on, there are a lot of people in very difficult situations out there health-wise. You've seen miracles, right? We always say this. You've seen miracles. Unfortunately, you've seen a lot of other things as well. But you have seen a lot of positive results, a lot of great doctors, a lot of great messengers of God who are there to help and know what to do. And you've seen a lot of families really bounce back many, many times.
I've been at weddings where they said that somebody would never survive. I've been a sandik at a bris. I've held the baby when they said this girl will never have a child. I've seen it all. I've seen it all, and I've seen, you know, you see the Lord, his hand all over the place.
No question about it.
You see people giving back. You know, we have counselors today in Camp Simcha who are campers.
I know, that was
we
incredible.
you know, it's an incredible thing. It's really just an incredible thing. It's a movement. High Lifeline has changed the world by how we view the sick and the disabled and the needy in our community, that we have to address it. And we believe that a lot of organizations came from our chutzpah, in a sense, of bringing out to the front.
Recognizing the need and dealing with it.
And we've coached a lot of organizations, actually, to come about. A lot of different needs in our community, and there's no reason why we shouldn't be able to address them in the best way possible.
At the time that we're doing this conversation, and obviously there'll be a lot more 12 hours from now when this is actually on the air, over $6.5 million. People can still contribute. Bike4chai.com, bike4chai.com. They can choose a member, they can choose a team, they can choose whoever they want. Just make sure.
They can even do it in your honor.
They can even do it in our honor. Right. I don't even have to ride.
Like an honorary biker.
I love it.
And actually, somebody just offered me $100,000 to bike. I said, but my life insurance policy is dealing with that. My wife, she'll be.
The business deal would work out. Personal note before we wrap up, Rabbi Scholar was a very close friend of my late brother who passed away from cancer.
Yes, yes.
And I am proud to say, talk about a positive, that there are people who now have been saved because of our push to get people screened with endoscopies because of his passing.
100%.
So, you know, obviously we miss him dearly, but that I was able to stand where he is now in Sanhedrin last week and say to him, I have good news for you. We're continuously saving lives because of you. It is an unbelievable feeling.
Moshe was one of my mentors my younger years.
That's for sure.
He influenced me greatly, and I miss him. I really do. And he was a good man, and his memory is special.
Thank you so much. Rabbi Scholar, continued success.
Thank you. Thank you all.
An amazing job being done by High Lifeline, Camp Simcha, and we're there Thursday for the greatest finish line ever. Thank you, Rabbi Scholar. Executive Vice President, of course. Am I right, or am I shortchanging it? Executive Vice President, High Lifeline, and doing an amazing job. We will continue with more the next time you hear us. We will actually be at the starting line on Wednesday morning, getting ready for the big start of the High Lifeline Bike for Chai. Thank you for listening to JM and the AM.
And now our transition has begun. It is now Wednesday morning, very early Wednesday morning here at JM and the AM, as we are at the Bike for Chai and sitting literally right next to the start line, where in just a little while there will be over 400 riders, I believe. Am I right?
I think close to 500 riders
at this point. Rabbi Shuli Fried is here. He's director of the New Jersey region of Chai Lifeline, executive director of Bike for Chai. Good early morning to you, Rabbi Fried.
Good morning, Nachum. How are you? Hope you got some sleep last night.
Well, of course. How could you not in this luxurious hotel? A beautiful place, the Crown Plaza here in Stamford. And they're taking very good care of you and your team, I hope.
Yes, they absolutely are. It's just in terms of the energy, and in terms of the logistics that we have to take care of, it's hard to sleep at times.
Oh, that's for sure. Rabbi Fried, so it's close to 500 riders, and we know that as of last night, close to $7 million has been raised. That figure continues to go up, which is pretty amazing, and people can continue to contribute at bikeforchai.com. I'm sure some people are already wondering if you've outgrown the place, if this has gotten so big and the Jewish community has responded so well that you may have outgrown this facility already.
Right. Interestingly enough, when people ask us what's the limit and why we had a waiting list this past year, you know, the open road has enough space for a lot of riders, and my incredible team that puts together this most professional cycling event out there can definitely accommodate more riders. But it's really the two challenges that face us in terms of accommodating more riders is, one, hotel space. We were confined by hotels that have to be in certain locations in the midweek event, which is, and we're only taking one night in a hotel for a large group,
right,
and corporate hotels can be difficult. And the second is camp. There is, you know, we're dealing with a camp that's, you know, dealing with very sick children, and there's a limit of how many people we can bring into camp. So that's really what confines us to being able to go much larger than 500. We had a very large waiting list this past year, and we probably sold out. I know we had opened up registration in January, first like pre-registration for past riders, but once we opened it up to the public, it sold out within 24 hours.
Isn't it amazing how just a couple of weeks ago we were using much lower figures in terms of riders, now we're close to 500. A lot of people at the last minute want to join this incredible rush, this incredible push to be part of it.
I don't think that in terms of the ridership number really gets established already in January. I think the big crush where we see that last minute crush is in fundraising. It's incredible how much gets raised in the last 10 days.
Right.
The last 10 days is really when people get into it and excited and have a tremendous push.
And we're told that tens of thousands of people participate, big and small contributions.
Bike for Chai is incredible, not only in the amount that it raises, but what's incredible is the amount of people and individual donors. There's so much value and there is such beauty in a guy that's raising $3,600 and $5,000. Not only because $3,600 and $5,000 is a lot of money, but some people put tremendous effort into that. And I always say this, Bike for Chai's success is not just in the money that's raised, but it's in the incredible commitment that people are putting into it. And when someone goes out there and raises $3,600 from 50, 60, 70 donors, the children and families of High Life, I know it and feel it and see that people are out there putting this effort in just for them.
All right, tell me about this morning, Rabbi Fried. What's going to happen over the next couple hours before we get to the actual start of the ride? A lot of logistics has to fall into place, and it seems, based on our experience last year, that somehow it does.
Right. So as everybody's sleeping, You know, there is a lot of logistics happening. There are people out on the road already putting out signage throughout the night. We can't go ahead and put it out days in advance because then it gets taken away or et cetera. So we have, I think, 250 signs that are meticulously going up throughout the route, from letting you know where rest stops are to letting you know encouraging lines. We have pictures of children along the route, along certain hills, tell you, don't worry, you know, you can do this, as well as our rest stop volunteers and rest stop groups and crews are already out on the road getting ready to set up. And, you know, the luggage volunteers are setting up already. There's a tremendous amount that's happening behind the scenes. But when the riders get up, they will hopefully get in their food, their energy drinks, etc. It's davening now at 5 o'clock, and then they have to go and change and check in their luggage. It's like an airport; your luggage gets checked in, and then when they get to the hotel tonight, their luggage hopefully will be in their room, so they can come in, shower, and go to their room and straight to celebrations.
Unbelievable! All this planning began after last year's race, essentially.
Morning after the Friday race.
All right, so you get a couple of days, and then
there's no couple of days.
Not even a couple of days. It just starts right away the next morning.
Right away. I mean, there's planning. The question is, what routes we'll take next year, and that we were already planning dates and hotels for next year.
Unbelievable. Rabbi Shuli Fried is here. Are other fundraising events asking for your help, asking for your advice when it comes to cycling events of this magnitude?
Sure. I try to help out as many as possible. You know, Bike for Chai definitely spurred a lot of interest in other organizations running similar type of events. And we think that we have the expertise to help out others, and there is room for other events to happen as well.
It's amazing how many different departments have to work in sync in order to make this work properly and for it to go off without a hitch, or at least what it looks like to us without a hitch.
Incredible, incredible amount of manpower needs. I mean, we have 350 volunteers. We have, besides staff under me, 4 full-time people working on Bike for Chai throughout the year. There is Beth and Bob, which is a company that produces the actual ride. There is leaders from SAG, from communications, and from rest stops, from medical to hotel logistics. Then you have a whole operation running just camp. It's just absolutely incredible what it takes to pull off. But I'll tell you, Nachum, what gives me the greatest source of pride is that I wear a lot of dual hats within Chai Lifeline, so I have my responsibilities as executive director of Bike for Chai. But I'm a social worker and I run the New Jersey, Pennsylvania region of Chai Lifeline. And what gives me the greatest pride is that the services of Chai Lifeline do not get interrupted due to Bike for Chai.
Right.
This morning in my office, there's a staff meeting that's going to be dealing with exactly what needs to be done for children in hospitals over the next week. And Bike for Chai does not interrupt it at all, only enhances it.
Which is unbelievable. When you wake up and it's weather like this, or when you don't wake up, but actually come down in the morning and it's weather like this, do you breathe a big sigh of relief?
We definitely do, because weather is everything, from safety to how many people we're going to have to pick up in SAG support vehicles. So this is the second year in a row that, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, God has been incredibly good to us, and he's been incredibly good to us throughout this event, and we have to give a tremendous thanks to Hashem for this incredible event. But I'll tell you, Nachum, we've had this event in pouring rain, and people had a great time.
Yeah, I think I've seen videos of that.
There's rain, there's heat, there's everything, but thank God today should be beautiful weather.
Looks like it. Looks like tomorrow as well, and that means the transition to tomorrow should go nicely. And then, of course, the world's greatest finish line, when tomorrow everybody enters camp, or the riders enter camp, and you see an incredible celebration and a real sense of accomplishment, not just among the riders. It seems that everybody around them, as they gather and celebrate with them, also feel a great sense of accomplishment.
It's a tremendous accomplishment, and there's only one way for me to describe the finish line, which is that if you haven't been there, there's no way to explain it properly. We can talk about the celebration, we can talk about the energy, the emotion, the sense of accomplishment, but ultimately you need to be there.
Yeah, it's really,
really experience.
It's really exhilarating. And the growth of this ride in such a short period of time, just a few years, is absolutely astounding.
Absolutely. We see tremendous Yata Dishmaya in this whole event.
Right, because just a few years ago we were talking about a few riders, and if you go way back, we're talking about one rider who decided.
2009, correct.
Who decided.
Left from my office, and then in 2010 is when.
So it was Lakewood where he left from.
Yes, absolutely. And in 2010 is when we had lay leadership that came in and really took it to the next level.
And we should mention that one of the teams has raised over $1 million, which is pretty amazing.
Team Meridian has raised over $1 million, and they put tremendous effort into that, really working all their contacts. And it's not just that they raised $1 million, but they inspire others to raise as well.
And I assume the website will continue to remain active even after the ride for people to continue to donate and to help out to whatever degree they can.
Absolutely.
Bikeforchai.com, bike4chai.com. Rabbi Fried, good luck today. Looks like you're anticipating a great start and a wonderful beginning to this incredible 2 days, and should be remarkable, as it always is.
Thank you so much, Nachum.
A pleasure. Rabbi Surly Fried, who's director of the New Jersey region of Chai Lifeline, executive director of Bike for Chai, one of the people that's working very hard to make sure that this two-day event is, in fact, spectacular. Michael Harbader is here. It is his first ride. He considers himself, or at least we're told, that he's one of the older cyclists on this tour. Good morning to you.
Good morning to you, Nachum.
How was your night? Was it calm? Was it serene?
Anything but. The hotel was absolutely fused with energy last night, the likes of which I don't recall ever seeing. I've been in this hotel for other events, Shabbatot and things like that, where we had more people, but nowhere near the energy.
At what point did you decide that you're going to do this ride?
I was thinking about it last year before the ride, but I had prior commitments. My grandson did the ride last year at the age of 16 by himself. And I kind of picked up his energy, his vibes, and I told myself last year, I've got to do this. I've got to get involved.
I'm really curious what it's like this morning for you. Nervousness, anxiety, wondering what the next couple of days will be like.
I put tremendous energy, tremendous koichus into training since last December. So much so that for the last few months, I haven't seen as much of my wife as I should. She complains I see more of the bicycle than her. And I collected money from people on the proposition that I'll do this ride, you give the money. Well, they gave the money. Now it's my turn to do my end and try and bike this 180 miles.
Right. Once today is out of the way, so to speak, the rest you're anticipating will go rather easily, or it doesn't work that way?
That'll depend on how I feel when I try to get out of bed tomorrow morning.
What's the most you've ever ridden one day?
103 miles.
Oh, so this is not like unusual for you, so to speak.
I've been training. I've done thousands of miles, but I've never quite done 110 miles with the kind of elevation we have to do today, and follow that up at 7:30 the next morning with another 75 and the kind of elevation we're doing tomorrow.
Right. Well, how do you anticipate the reception at Camp Simcha based on what you've heard?
Bike for Chai and Chai Lifeline put out a video each year of the year's event. I've seen the 2015 video more times than I can count. I can picture it. I can see it. I can feel it. I have a pretty good idea of what's going to happen when we get to camp. And incidentally, as part of my training, a few weeks ago, I did the last 40 miles of this ride. I went to New Jersey, left from New Jersey, and actually rode up to camp because I had heard how hard the last 10 or 12 miles was, and I wanted to see for myself. So I've actually seen Camp Simcha, and that, too, is incredible.
How did the last 40 go?
It was tough, but the weather was much hotter and more humid than it is today, and we lucked out weather-wise.
So you must be walking into this ride with a great deal of confidence. You've done hundreds of miles. You did the last 40 already up to camp.
I'm walking into this ride hoping for tremendous siyata deshmaya.
I can imagine. How was it difficult or easy to raise money for this cause?
I thought I'd have a tremendous amount of trouble raising. I'm not a schnorrer. I'm not a collector by nature. I don't like hitting people up. Somehow, I found this to be not too hard. I'm in business, so I approached vendors and customers as well, responded very, very generously. I sent emails out to my family. I've sent out multiple emails since January when I first signed up. I set a goal of $10,000, hoping I could get there. I raised it in stages seven times to $23,000, and as of this morning, I'm at $22,500.
Wow, very nice. Mazel tov on that. Tremendous accomplishment. Michael Harbader, among the older riders, it's his first ride, and he is going to be taking off from this very spot within the next couple hours. And we wish you the best of luck.
Thank you very much, Nachum.
Thank you very much, and congratulations. And to all the riders, we say congratulations. This is JM in the AM. We are at Bike for Chai. We are now at the start line, which will be filled with people in just the next couple of hours. People who are riding for Chai Lifeline, you can go ahead and donate by going to the website at bikeforchai.com. Again, that's bike number 4chai.com. And you're able at that point to dedicate your donation to any specific rider, any specific team. As of this morning, it gets closer and closer to $7 million, which is an incredible amount. Morty Leibovitz, is it?
Correct.
Morty Leibovitz is here, Team Symphony from Chicago, Illinois. And Asanal Davis is here, Team Symphony, riding for his first year, also from Chicago, Illinois. Good morning to both of you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Looks like you have the vim and vigor for people who want to get up and ride 180 miles for the children of Chai Lifeline. Am I accurate?
Spot on. We are nothing more than nothing. No better place I want to be than 4 o'clock in the morning.
At the start line of the ride.
Start line of the ride. Exactly.
How does it feel that being the first year for you?
For me, it's nervous, exciting, and just not sure what to expect. You watch the videos for the whole year while you're training, and you're not sure what the etiquette and the protocol is, and you know, and just making sure you can handle it. But I just can't wait. I can't wait to just be in it already
and
just
hit the road.
Hit the road.
How long was this training process for you?
Well, for me, it was actually 2 years, believe it or not, because I signed up 2 years ago, and then a week before the ride last year, I got sick. Hi. My doctor didn't let me go, so it's been a two-year process, so the excitement has really been building, and just can't wait to hit the road.
Is this your first time?
My first time.
So for both of you, it's the first time.
Yes, this is Team Chicago, first year.
The first time that Team Chicago is part. How many people are in Team Chicago?
We're 12 guys.
Very nice. Boy, oh boy.
Morty's our captain. He put it together. We started training. Surly came out to Chicago March. We were just looking at the date yesterday, March 3rd. Surly Free came out to Chicago. He said, we got to get a team from Chicago.
That's going. Pretty recent, March 3rd.
Yeah, March 3rd. So started training probably March 4th. I don't know if that's a Shabbos or a Friday, but it was. we started training
so
pretty much after.
So
that.
How does one start training? For those who are listening and are wondering if they could sneak into this ride next year, what's the process? Well, how does it begin? Look.
Chicago is one of those cities where you only get to ride 6 months out of the year, right. So it's a little bit more challenging than if you live in LA or one of those cities. But you know, we try to ride at least 3-4 times a week, and as the months continued, just build up the mileage, you know, until we got to the point where we were ready to go. Another interesting challenge the Chicago folks get to experience is that Chicago is flat.
Right.
And I understand there's some hills today.
So they say.
Did anybody hear about the hills?
Our previous guest actually went and did the last 40 miles up the camp at some point. I'm wondering, you guys being, you know, 1,000 miles away, if you're wondering what that's like.
We have been wondering and trying to imitate it in Chicago, riding out to places like Barrington Hills, Illinois, trying to get that feel for the elevation, because there is nothing scarier than those emails from Yoli and from Surly saying, don't worry, the elevation is only like 8,000 feet. And things like that, and we're like doing 2,500 maybe on a great day in one of our training days. But it's like Morty said, it's building it up, and just there's the distance, and there's going for the long rides, which the wives hate, and then there's the elevation, which is just something you don't really know until you're on it. And hopefully with the team and with the adrenaline and with everybody around you, they'll pull us up the hill.
Morty and Asanal here, Team Symphony. Why is it called Team Symphony?
Team Symphony is for Symphony Healthcare. Symphony Post Acute Network actually is the correct name. David Hartman is the CEO of that company, and he got our fundraising off to a great start, giving us $36,000. When we first started this, we didn't know what to expect from the whole community. You know, Chai Lifeline is a great, great organization, and they do a lot of fundraising in Chicago. But for our team, we said, you know, we're going to go out there and we're going to get someone who wants to name the team for $36,000, kick off towards our $100,000 benchmark, and he jumped right in. So David Hartman, thank you so much. Symphony Post Acute Network. So we named it Team Symphony, and then the rest is history.
Well, rightfully so. So Team Symphony from Chicago, 12 people. How different do you feel physically than from before this training process?
From before, well, we feel great now.
Morty, I lost 25 pounds training, so I feel different physically. Morty's a beast. So like he said, he's been doing it for 2 years. It's like for him, it's just routine. For me, I was up at 4 o'clock and just, okay, do I put on the jersey already? I'm going downstairs. You know, you're just like,
yeah, you look like, you look like you have a lot of energy.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I'm ready for this thing to start now.
I'm ready to go. We gotta dive in first, so I gotta get that done. But yeah,
it looks like you were thinking of a practice run this morning.
I think that's what everybody thought on the elevator on the way down. Like, where's he going? We're not starting for like 3 hours. But yeah, it's gonna be fun. It's gonna be a lot of fun.
Collectively, as a team, I think we've lost a couple hundred pounds. So
yes,
it's been fun watching everybody disappear and getting to the point where we are today. We're gonna try to stick together on the ride and. The idea here is it's a ride, not a race,
right.
And we're really looking to have a great time.
And I assume the team will try its best to, at the same time, to all get into camp at the same time and finish the ride at the same time.
Sure. Finishing that finish line, like I heard on your from your previous guest, you can't watch that video enough times. You watch it, and the goosebumps and the feeling of that. It's the world's best finish line. I think that's the best line ever. No pun intended.
Good point. Did you sleep at all last night?
Yeah.
Slept
for about 4 or 5 hours.
So you were able to take that energy and just relax
for
a little while. Well, I wish both Nisanal and Morty, Team Symphony out of Chicago, Illinois, the best of luck. We'll be looking for you at the start line. We'll be looking for you at the finish line tomorrow.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for having us on.
Anybody who wants to... support High Lifeline, and you can find them, by the way. You could search online on the website and find the names of Sonal Davis and Morty Leibovitz. Anybody out there from Chicago who wants to do that or from anywhere else, and you can sponsor them or any other rider during Bike for Chai or even after Bike for Chai. Go to the website, bikeforchai.com. Rabbi David Goldwasser's words, Zecher Nishmas HaRav Zev Rabbi Yosef HaLevi and Esther Basser Rabbi Yosef HaLevi. Here is Rabbi David Goldwasser with Morning Chizuk.
Good morning. We're going to be continuing with our series on Chinuch Habonim, education. The Altar of Kelm used to interpret the pasuk Chanoich Lenar Al Pi Darkoi, that even when a person gets older and he has no one to educate him, he should continue to be Mechanich himself. He should give himself Musar. The Gemara in Ksubas tells us about Yoshafat HaMelech. When the Melech used to see a Talmud Chacham, he would stand up from his throne, he would hug him and kiss him, he would call him Rebbe, Rebbe, Murray, Murray. We see from this that even when he was older and had already had the honor of the kingdom, with all of this, he was still Mechabed Talmidei Chachamim. He gave honor to Torah scholars. We don't find there was another person giving him Musar. We must say, therefore, that he gave himself Musar all of his days. In the Shelis and Shuvas Chaim Shal, it says that we learn from here that if a person would be sitting, holding the Sefer Torah, and his Rebbe would walk in front of him, if there's no place to rest the Sefer, a person would have to stand, even if it means that the Sefer Torah will also stand. Where do we see this from? From Yehoshaphat HaMelech. We know that a melech has a Sefer Torah continually in his hand. Yet, we see that he stood up for the Talmud Chacham. Hagon Rav Shalom Shvadron was a mashkiach in Yeshiva Tiferes Tzvi. The yeshiva once had the great privilege that the Zakan Bal Musar, Hagon Rav Elia Lopian, came to visit. He gave a shir for the bochrim of the yeshiva. Just as Rav Lopian was about to open the door to leave, Rav Shvadron lay down on the floor. The Talmidim didn't know what was going on. Rav Shvadron should do such a thing? After the great Goyen left, Rav Shvadron went to the Bim and said, I will explain to you my actions. Chazal tell us, Peve mizabek ba'af ragleim, in the dust of their feet. It's not metaphorical. It's not allegorical. It is real Torah Chinuch. This has been Rabbi David Goldwasser bringing you morning
Good morning.
Chinuch, Torah education.
All right, sorry about that. JM and the AM, Rabbi David Goldwasser's morning chizuk, and I thank Rabbi Goldwasser. Anybody who wants to support Bike for Chai, as tens of thousands have already done, and we are here at the starting line, not feeling the excitement of the start line yet because we're still here way in advance as people are davening shachris and making their final preparations before coming out here. But soon it's going to be a very, very exciting sight and an unbelievable place to be. The start line with hundreds of riders, close to 500, heading to a Camp Simcha over these 2 days, 180 miles. Shalom Yeager is a USA Cycling Cat 3 road cyclist. I like reading this as if I know what I'm talking about. It means he's competed in 25 qualifying races with a minimum of 10 top 10 finishes with fields of 30 or more riders, or 20-pack finishes with fields of more than 50 riders. It's his first year with Bike for Chai. Shalom Yeager, welcome to JM and the AM.
Thank you.
Where are you from?
I'm from L.A.
Oh, Los Angeles. There you go. So how does one get to this point where you're, you know, it seems to me, racing on a regular basis on your bicycle?
Yeah, definitely. Bicycles have always been something that I was interested in. I started when I was in yeshiva, and I didn't really get the opportunity to pursue it, which kind of frustrated me a little bit. But once I left yeshiva, I was able to pursue it on my own and dedicate time to training, which is pretty much 5 or 6 days a week.
Yeah, I can imagine.
And
when it comes to these races, is Shabbos an issue, or are a lot of them taking place on Shabbos?
It can be, so that's also another frustrating factor, because all the big races and stage racing, which is multiple day events,
right,
are where the competition is a lot better, generally have a day on Shabbos, and if you don't do the day on Shabbos, you can't do the next day.
Right.
So, I mean, I guess I take the opportunities that are given to me.
Understood. So most of these are one-day races, or not necessarily?
Yeah, mostly.
Most are one-day races. And all of these, or most of the ones you've participated in, have been in California? Have you been out here before or other areas of the country?
I travel a little bit, but mostly within driving distance of my home. So that's taken me to, I guess, within 10 hours,
right.
Arizona, Oregon.
So silly question, but what is the difference between these riders you're going to be with today and those that you're normally with during these races? I would assume it's a completely different atmosphere and a obviously much more competitive one that you're used to.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, guys that are racing generally ride regularly, and they have a lot more confidence, whether it's true or false, in their handling ability. So they'll take more risks, and they just generally ride faster and like putting the pain in each other's legs and just riding really hard.
And I guess that from a layman's standpoint, one of the things we're always curious about is how, when riding so closely and at such high speed, you know, to other riders and at such high speed, you're able to navigate to the point where generally, I would hope, you avoid collisions and injuries, etc. Isn't that difficult to do?
That can be part of the race. You know, if there's more than like 30 or 40 or 50 racers, then it can be challenging to move up in a field. So there are some races that I've been in that were like over 100 racers and very competitive. So part of the skill and your ability as a racer is being able to move up and navigate that chaos, I guess.
Shalom Yeager is with us. What is it about cycling? What is it? What's the attraction that makes it so incredible, that makes it such an amazing sport to participate in?
Well, I guess as a kid, when I first got into it, it was my first freedom. I biked to school, which was all of a mile or so, with my brothers, and I was able to go anywhere I wanted pretty much, because my parents were pretty free with that, because it's a bike and how far can you go already, right?
Right.
and then in yeshiva, it morphed into something a lot bigger, because I had a road bike and I was able to go a lot further, and there was public transportation that was off limits, and places that they, I guess, didn't want the students to go. So right. I was able to kind of do my own thing and not have anybody bother me.
So it's about freedom. It's about being out there and just hitting the open road, huh?
I guess that's what got me into it.
What got you out here? Why New York? Why Bike for Chai?
I really was interested in it because a lot of the my friends that I ride with in LA have been doing it for 4 or 5 years, and the things that I've heard about the event were very exciting, and so far they haven't disappointed.
Oh, very nice.
They've exceeded expectations.
And what do you anticipate once you leave the start line here?
I'm kind of taking a wait and see approach. I mean, I'm hoping that there will be other guys that are wanting to ride fast, and we'll take it from there.
So you might be looking to win this leg that starts this
morning.
Well,
I wouldn't say it's a race. I just want to ride.
I understand, but it wouldn't bother you if you're the first person at the hotel tonight.
No.
That wouldn't bother you at all. I have a feeling, knowing the group that's here, that there's some competitive nature out there. You'll probably find people who are hitting the open road at as high a speed as they can. Shalom Yeager, how has the fundraising gone? Have people been supportive of the cause?
Definitely. I lane at a shul at home, and they put it on their weekly newsletter, and they announced it in shul, and that was definitely very beneficial. And Facebook friends, cycling partners and friends.
And I'm handed a note. Are you riding with the Tour de France?
Nope.
Ah, okay.
Are you participating? You're riding with them in terms of, is that an exciting thing for you? You've never ridden.
Are you aware of the fact that Tour de France riders are going
I'm
to be
aware of that, yeah. It's definitely exciting. I've never met them before. There are some pro riders in LA that I get the chance to see and ride with occasionally.
Oh, that's cool.
So, yeah, being in LA is a good place for cycling. Well, but, yeah, I mean, these are two of the really big names in cycling.
Well, good luck. We are putting our money on you to win this first leg starting this morning. Don't disappoint.
All right.
The pressure is on. Shalom Yeager, we're kidding around, of course, because it's just a ride, everybody, but it's a ride that raises a tremendous amount of money and does a tremendous amount for Chai Lifeline and Camp Simcha. You have an opportunity to support the cause by going to the website bikeforchai.com, bike4chai.com. And you can also watch everything right now on video. Go to our homepage at NahumSiegel.com. Go to our home screen at NahumSiegel.com. You can see the entire show as it's going on here from the start line. We are looking at the start line. The shot you're seeing of us is us watching the starting line. And as you would suspect, even an hour or two before the ride begins, there's plenty of work going on and the things being set up at the start of the race. Miriam Al-Wallach rejoins me.
Good morning. I apologize for that note, but as a guy, I apologize.
Don't worry.
I'll hear about it.
It's now given us half a day of conversation.
That's
later on.
That's great. but what's interesting is that he hopes to be one of the first people at the hotel tonight, but he's riding against these guys who have competed in the Tour de France.
Yeah, but they're not going to...
They're not, I mean, he's in it for different.
Yeah, this guy.
He's a gamer.
This guy really wants to be the first in the hotel. I could only imagine that the Tour de France people look at this completely differently than what they do in their competitive lives, I would guess. As most people would, you know.
One of the things I noticed, though, last night with one of the Tour de France.
Yeah, we're used to the.
Exactly. Riders. Yeah, was how he interacted with some of the younger kids last night in wheelchairs and clearly not in great health, and just the affection that you could see one for the other. I mean, there's a real level of humanity in this ride. There's a real connection, but it wasn't the Jewish thing. You know, there are obviously we note last night that this is a community in and of itself, and frankly, we're seeing all these, you know, all the hawk, and we're watching all the interactions, and it's always fun to watch. But then you have people who are here for the sake of riding, and who right. are not, they don't know the families, and they don't know the community, but they're here, and then they get touched by a child and his story, and they've watched the videos, and they understand what it's about, and so this is beyond, no, it's not a race, it's a ride, but it's a ride with meaning, and you can see it, right.
They're taken by the cause,
yeah.
And the cause anybody who observes the work of Chai Lifeline and anybody who sees the families and children that they service, you can't help but be taken by the whole experience. And last night, as you just mentioned, you saw my reaction and, in general, everybody's reaction when some of these children were, in fact, around, and it was obvious that there were people, teams, right, riding for them. You know, it's just, it's incredibly inspiring, and, you know, you thank God that you have what you do have, and that you don't have some of the challenges that others have. And I guess that's universal. I guess that's universal, that everybody, even outside the Jewish community, would think that way. Why not?
Right, and you look at these guys. I mean, some of these guys are in tip-top shape. Some of these guys not so much in tip-top shape, but have clearly done all of this training that they're ready for the road ahead. I mean, there's... You have to give each one of them a tremendous credit just to the level of commitment that it takes, and the mental commitment, not just the physical commitment and the training commitment, but the level of mental commitment that it takes to know that you are riding thousands of feet up in elevation today, and that's all got to get done today.
That is so true.
That has to get done by the end of the day. And yes, the weather is, I mean, it's almost like a camp morning up here.
Yeah. It was much chillier than I thought it would be, or it is rather. And one of our, Michael, who was with us earlier, commented that he's not worried about day one, he's worried about day two.
Right.
And that is where, again, you know, somebody like Shalom, who we just spoke to, is probably not that concerned about day two and what he'll feel like the morning of the second day of the ride. But those who are just doing this for the first time or right, are not used to the type of training that he might be used to, they are concerned about, you know, what that's going to be like waking up tomorrow morning. It's a lot of anticipation, a lot of energy, a lot of excitement, a lot of anxiety, I'm sure, and it is really something to just be part of it and see what everyone's doing. Every one of these is a story in and of itself.
Oh, for sure. And before we started, or I should say before we restarted the program, I took a little tour of the bike hold. And Jamie has a bunch of pictures that we'll be posting on social media. I posted one picture on Twitter this morning on my account. It is not normal to see this. I mean, first of all, it's an awesome sight to see this sea of bikes. And then getting a little bit closer. I mean, this isn't like the bike rack I have in my garage. Like, you get a little bit closer and you see this guy added this and this guy added that. And I'm sure that water bottle holder was placed significantly on that angle. And there's so much time in these... Bikes are incredibly, incredibly valuable. I think that there was one on display last night. They go for thousands of dollars.
Yeah.
And the detailing packages. And there was one bike I took a picture of that said Guru on the side of it. I don't know, like, you also have to consider each one of these guys has to learn how to maintain their bike. If you get a flat, you get a blowout, you get something. I mean, it's an entire level of skill, not just beyond the ride itself. I run, so I put on my sneakers and, you know, I go. But this is a whole nother level. I'm not going to say of crazy. This is a whole nother level of commitment.
Yeah, the equipment commitment is quite a commitment. That's for sure. JM and the AM with a reminder, you can support Bike for Chai by going to the website, bikenumber4chai.com, bikenumber4chai.com. Participate in that way, and you can choose a rider or team to sponsor, and even if you're listening to this once the ride has concluded, you could still go ahead and donate online. There was, many of you may recall, just a couple of years back, AKA Pella has a Bike for Chai song, which alludes to some of the some of the things that we're talking about getting up early in the morning and training hundreds of miles and listening to what organizers of Bike for Chai tell some of their participants or future participants or those who they're trying to convince to participate, AKA Pella, a song that we call Bike for Chai, simply enough. Here it is at JM in the AM.
We're riding tomorrow at 5 a.m.? Are you crazy?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm in.
Hey, does anyone have a spare Clif Bar? I forgot mine at home.
Worn down, my heart is aching, stuck here, I can't take the waiting, deep sigh, praying to let me go, whoa, as I look out, I see something in the distance, feeling that spark of hope, and suddenly now I know, nothing's gonna stop me this time. That's why I'm biking for high. Pushing together as one, a united peloton, to the world's greatest finish line. That's why we're biking for high.
Just got my new speed plays. They're awesome. They make you faster? Totally. I don't think they're working.
Guys, where's Margulies? I'm gonna kill that guy. He said there's no hills on the first day. Just got another KOM. The guy is a monster.
Did you hear? Shlomo switched from skating on 8 wheels to a brand new Pini Dogma.
Nice.
Are you going to be using your second bottle? Mine is already empty.
You guys just did the day one route. I think we should too. Who's in?
Definitely me.
Absolutely.
I'm in.
Can we make a stop soon? I think I need more chamois butter.
You got new zip car wheels?
Yep, they were on sale for only $1,500.
Do they make you faster?
Totally.
I don't think they're working.
Guys, can we stop at the next very big tree?
That is the Bike for Chai anthem, I guess we can call it, done by AKA Pella and Friends. And here we are at JM in the AM. Haskell Bennett, who's, I think, always described as a community leader and activist.
No leader, just trying just to make it happen.
Some terms or some titles stick, and that seems to always be yours.
Yeah.
To us, you're somebody who's always involved and ready to help at a moment's notice, and you took the opportunity to help. This is now the third time. Fourth time?
Fourth time.
I've been misinformed again. It is the fourth time that you are riding with Bike for
every mile. Three other times every mile so far.
Team Uri. It's in memory of Uri Benenfeld, a young man who died after a long battle with a form of muscular dystrophy. How did you get involved with Team Uri?
I know the family for many, many years, people that we were close with. I'm a Hot Solon member for the last nearly 24 years, so deeply involved on the medical side, the personal side. And he was a wonderful boy, lived and breathed Camp Simcha, lived and breathed life, just loved people. And when the opportunity arose after he was nifter to just try to do something a little bit different outside of the box, we got together. The family had been, you know, very deeply affected and impacted by Chai Lifeline.
and Camp Simcha. It just felt like a natural opportunity for all of us to get together, friends.
How large is Timuri?
I think there are 7 or 8 of us, depending on who could actually make it through to the finish line.
or depending on who made it out of bed this
but,
morning.
But of much more importance, Team Uri raised $133,000 as we speak.
Wow.
So people can still go to Team Uri, to my page, to anybody on Team
Uri.
On bikevachai.com. $133,000. A lot of kids in Camp Simcha will be helped that money. Smiles, joy. A rest for the parents of those children. It's the whole package. And if you go to Camp Simcha and you see for yourself who we're impacting and who we're helping, it's a no-brainer. So we keep trying to do this.
You know, I know you for a while, and I know it's important to you to encourage others to always get involved. So last night, as you're here and you're seeing this group of people getting together in the hundreds, and with all the support that they have, because every one of them has an unbelievable support system, both here and at home, how does that feel to you? How does it feel, this kind of community effort taking place and kicking off this morning?
First of all 501 riders have families that are supporting them. That's number one. Number two, they have friends and colleagues, business associates who supported them financially. So I think if people get another email from me, I don't think people are going to just start ignoring my phone calls and emails if they haven't done already. But seriously, incredible support team, incredible Kali Yisrael. It's just tapestry of great people. I just came from davening Sfardim, Ashkenazim, Hasidish, Litvish, the great kaleidoscope that is Klal Yisrael, is to a great degree right here. You have all kinds of people, supported by all kinds of people. You're going to see the SAG support teams, Hasidish kids and Litvish kids and Yeshivish kids. It's a summertime where it's August, what are we, August 2nd, August 3rd?
Yeah.
You know, what is a better way to spend some quality time doing something so wonderful, helping so many people? I can't, you know, this is a...
What do you think of the start line? What goes through your mind as you anticipate just being feet away from and minutes away from starting this whole
thing? So our audience, I don't know if our audience knows, it's 5:40 a.m., right? So I really didn't sleep that well last night because there's always a little bit of jitters, and you know you have to do 110 miles today. The weather's supposed to be phenomenal, but I've done this ride already in the rain and in 95 degrees. So what goes through your mind? Hydrate. Say tefillos aderech.
Get me through it.
Put on my tzitzis and let's go. Pedal away.
And as you're riding, we were told that there are photos of campers. There are there are slogans that keep you going.
Now, if you think this is tough, see what a kid going through cancer is suffering through. That kind of stuff.
Right.
Yeah, I remember those
things. So you'll be seeing those later today.
You know, I'll tell you the truth. I like the flat ground, and every now and then you get a present, the downhill. But you know that there's a climb coming. So you enjoy the moments when they're there. But I think that there are more uphills than downhills. So.
Well, the downhills go very, very quickly compared to the uphills, huh?
I think it's a story of life.
Yeah.
I bike this ride that I've never anticipated in my life, in my wildest dreams, that I would be able to do at this stage of my life, 180 miles, 175 miles, whatever it might be. And it's the fourth year I'm doing it. And something special.
Were you a cyclist before?
Never in my life, and I won't look at my bicycle until next year again. I only do this. I only bike for this cause.
But do you train?
I trained for the last month. This year was a little bit tougher because the weather wasn't so good. I wasn't feeling, my feet weren't so great. I picked up my bike July 3rd. It was the first, I think it was a Sunday, July 3rd, July 4th, whatever that was, that weekend. And I've pumped for the last 4 weeks, every weekend, every opportunity I had for the last 4 weeks to get it done. What's going to make it happen? And anybody who's listening wants to give me a little tefillah, a little little chizuk, so daven for me and daven for all the riders that we should be protected and we should be safe. Doing it for a good cause, shluch and mitzvah, ein and nezaken. So hopefully Hashem will see that we're doing this for the right reasons and take very good care of us. We are his soldiers, and we're just trying to... help in the battle to help his kindleach.
What is a SAG support team, by the way?
SAG support team. I'm not really sure what it stands for, support something or other, but basically they're the guys and people who ride along with you, making sure that if your tire blows out.
You see them often during the ride?
They're there from the moment you start until the moment you end, except for us late guys. It's going to take me 12 hours to do this. I'm going to leave at 7 a.m. Last 3 years, I've come in at 7 p.m. I remember coming into Scranton. The sun was already coming down in Scranton over the mountain. But look, it's a bike ride. It's you, the bike, and nature, and all the things that come along with it. Broken bikes, people unfortunately fall, bruises, scrapes, that should be the worst of it.
Equipment problems and injuries.
Equipment problems and injuries, and just making sure that there's water. People need a breather.
So you're in the hotel 12 hours after this start. Do we have any idea how long it'll take the first rider to get to the hotel?
Not 12 hours. They're probably there at 1 o'clock. They're probably not sure what to do with themselves.
Relaxing with all that.
You know what? I'm having more fun than they are.
There you go. Haskell Bennett, who will be spending a lot of time on the road
today. That's it, man.
Tremendous amount of time on the road today.
I don't like to use the word Mesiris Nefesh, but this is an opportunity. You know, B'chol Nafshecha. When we say B'chol Nafshecha.
Give it your all.
For Haskell Bennett, that's B'chol Nafshecha.
Thank you, Haskell. Continued good luck.
Thank you, Nachum. Good luck. We'll see you along the way.
We may actually be checking in with Haskell tomorrow morning after the start of the second day of the ride. We'll see if we can make that happen.
Okay. Have a great day, everybody.
Thank you so much. You as well. You have an interesting day ahead, to say the least. And we say good luck to you and to all the riders. BikeForChai.com gives you all the information. BikeForChai.com gives you all the opportunities to support the cause and be part of all this. Yossi Rotberg is with us. Yossi has decided to be in Bike for Chai. He, at 9 years old, learned to ride a bicycle. He's been overcoming many hurdles since then. How did you? First of all, good morning to you.
Good morning. I'm still sleeping.
Good night. Is this the first time you're doing Bike for Chai?
Yes.
Are you nervous, anxious? How would you describe your feelings right now as we look at the starting line and get ready for this momentous occasion?
Before I even answer that question, I want to give a shout-out to the founder of Bike for Chai, who's actually being my shadow today, David Eggert.
Yeah.
I've been neighbors with David Eggert all my life, so Bike for Chai is not a foreign concept.
So you're familiar with the story that he just had to get his bike to camp somehow.
You know what? I'm going to say it bluntly. It takes one nut, but look what he did. $6 million, who would have believed?
It is unbelievable.
So yes, I am nervous, I am anxious, but that's life. Life is like a bike ride. If you're going uphill, you know you're getting places. And if you're going downhill, if it's easy, then you know you're in trouble.
So going uphill should be looked at as a positive experience.
That's the way I always looked at life. I didn't walk till I was about 5 years old. And I just kept going from there.
And how did you get an interest in bicycling?
Well, it's a great physical therapy. And again, I learned how to ride a bike later.
Right.
And I always rode, and then Bike for Chai came along and they said you can be an inspiration for people. And now that I'm a married man with a father of two, I said I conquered my challenge. Now I have to give it to somebody else.
Boy.
And if even one person sees, no matter how many miles I do today, my attempt is to do as much as I can. I don't know if I'll finish Bike for Chai's ride, but I'm going to finish mine. And if one parent of a special needs child or someone in a similar situation like mine says, wow, if that guy can ride, then I can raise my child.
Did you have a lot of naysayers along the way? People who thought that some of these physical challenges were beyond your capabilities? And
well, I don't like to focus on the negative because then I'm in trouble. But yeah, there are people that told me that you're getting your biting off more than you could chew. You're never going to be able to raise the minimum of the financial, the fundraising, but Kananara did a lot better than that. I had people say, the most you did a 30-mile ride, you're not going to be able to do the entire ride today. But like my brother and my wife were standing here, today is bike riding. Nothing else. No matter how long it takes, I have 14 hours of daylight and
You plan on making the most of it.
Whatever I do is an accomplishment because that's my ride.
So you're not the type of person that would in any way in this conversation certainly want to concentrate on any of the challenges and hurdles. Today is a morning where you wake up and you say to yourself, as it sounds like you probably say to yourself every day, that today you're going to accomplish as much as possible. And today it just happens to be that accomplishment is going to be on the road on a bicycle.
Yes, because I'm a married man, father of two. Again, I have a full-time job. I take every day as it comes. You know, I'm not looking, oh my gosh, I have 110 miles to do, because I want to give a shout out to my team. I'm part of Team Lakewood, led by Jaco Forsheimer.
How large is Team Lakewood?
Yeah, I don't even know.
It's a big one?
It's close to 20 guys, I would say. Nice. But there's more than 20 riders from Lakewood, so
right.
He told me just ride, and he's quick. He told me it's all a blur to him, So I told him, if you compete through life, you don't enjoy it. So I'm going to enjoy the ride because I'll take in the scenery.
There's a print piece about you, Yossi Rotberg, which is called Profile in Courage. Do you consider yourself to be courageous?
No. But I trust, and I trust that I do what I have to do, you know? I'm not I'm social, but I'm not very, like, rah-rah, Camp Simcha, making a lot of noise. I just want to inspire people.
Well, and you're certainly doing that, I can tell you that much. How many miles have you been riding in order to train for this day?
A day after Bike for Chai last year, I was watching the YouTube videos, and I'm like, I wish I could be part of this, you know? And my wife says, stop talking and go buy a bike. So I've been riding since last year, August.
And in a typical day or a typical training session, you could do how many miles? I'm just curious, when you say that you're questioning if you're going to be able to complete today.
I'm not even questioning it. This is my ride.
So whatever happens, happens.
Yes.
And whatever you complete.
Again, because...
And that's what you had to complete.
Right. And every time that I get out on my bike, it's because I'm worried about time because my kids are waiting for me, my family's waiting for me, my job's waiting for me. I said it. Today's bike riding. My boss is away. My family's here to support me, but today's riding.
It's you and the road.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And Yasha Koch for all the amazing fundraising. And a big Yasha Koch for being such an inspiration. I can only imagine when families in difficult situations see someone like you and hear about your story, I can only imagine how encouraged they are.
So one thing I would like to mention, everybody was talking about the children of High Life Fun last night. I want to make a shout out to all the parents of the children of High Lifeline, because if not for parents like mine who saw me born with physical challenges and said they could have thrown in the towel, said, all right, this is who he is, but they strove to raise me the best they can, and that's why I want to give strength and courage to the parents that even though it's in a difficult situation now and even though it looks hard, keep going and they'll be the best they can.
An honor to meet you.
Thank you. Same here.
We'll break after our station ID. This is America's one and only Jewish Moments in the Morning radio program, heard on listener-sponsored WFMU East Orange, WMFU Mount Hope, Rockland County at 91.9 on the FM dial. Broadcasting from Bike for Chai, usually at our Sonia and Robert Gold studios in Jersey City, New Jersey. Around the world on the web, jmnam.org, and of course on the NSN app. Hour number three on this Wednesday broadcast of JM in the AM, and we are at the start line. The sun is up. We are anticipating an amazing start to the ride to Bike for Chai, with over 500 riders lined up or will be lined up in front of us very, very soon. Among them will be Neil Ephraim Singel, who is here from Detroit, Michigan, with his son Yudi Singel, who is the youngest rider, just passed his bar mitzvah. Mazel tov to you.
Thank you.
Just passed his bar mitzvah. He also just completed his first century ride, 100 miles. And we should, I guess, emphasize that you're, of course, that because he's 13 years old, you're here to not only ride, but to be with him throughout the entire ride. Am I right, Mr. Singel?
Correct. Actually, he's my chaperone today.
Oh, so is that how it works?
Yeah, that's how it's working.
How did this whole thing start? That who's been riding first and who's been expressing an interest in riding?
Well, I started a couple of years ago. About 3 years ago, we started, we got into Bike for Chai, and I spoke with you last year, filled you in a little bit about the D team in Detroit.
Right.
And Yudi's been, tugging at the shirt, asking to ride himself. So 11 years old, a little too young, 12 years old, perhaps a little too young, but... Like you say, when you turn bar mitzvah, he's a man. He can make some of his own decisions. So
even as crazy as these, of riding for Bike for Chai. When did you complete this 100-mile ride we're talking about?
About a month ago.
Yeah.
What was that like? Is it easy for you?
It's not easy.
Not easy at all, huh?
No.
I would think someone as young as you would just happen, like that.
No. Why don't you want to tell the whole story about what you did on that Friday?
Tell us the story, please.
We took off of school in the morning.
I took off of school. We went at 7 o'clock and we rode. We took we had a 25-mile loop that we did 4 times. Yeah.
Needless to say, he slept very well there, Chavez.
I can only imagine. How much do you enjoy bicycling? And it must be an amazing passion of yours at this point.
It's awesome.
What is it about it that's so incredible?
It's just fun getting out and just riding, just...
And I would assume most of your riding's been local in Detroit, in that area?
Yeah.
So this must be extra exciting for you, getting to New York and
yeah.
doing a route, a course that obviously you've never done before.
It's actually my first time in New York.
Really?
Yeah.
And here's where you are. at Bike for Chai. And the hills, the ups and downs that this route has as a reputation. Does that scare you? Does it invigorate you?
What would you say? Not really, no.
Are you anticipating any major problems with it? Do you consider it a challenge? What can you tell us about this unique New York route that everyone keeps focusing on?
Just take your time.
Simple as that.
Yeah.
How long will it take you to complete today's... about how long will it take? How long will it take you to complete the 100 miles?
10 hours.
Wow.
Something like that.
So what do you think of all this?
I think it's fantastic. I think, you know, Yudi, because he's so light, he's on the downhills, he's not as quick, but on those uphills, he's flying by us. Like, you know, he's got no weight on him, so he just pumps up those hills, and he's up there kind of quick.
So he's got a big advantage, huh?
Especially on the uphills. So I think like a day like today, he's going to thrive. He's going to do extremely well.
Do doctors have an opinion about 13-year-olds doing these kind of rides?
So we actually went to a couple doctors beforehand just to get him checked out physically to make sure that he's healthy enough, make sure that he has enough nutrients nutrition-wise. We discussed it with the co-chair as well as with his doctors to make sure that he was on a very strict nutrition plan to make sure that he was healthy and doing this ride properly.
What did you eat this morning?
I ate a half a bagel.
Yeah.
A waffle.
Yeah.
And some coffee.
You had coffee this morning?
Yeah.
Why, you think you'd have trouble staying awake during this thing? What do you plan on eating and drinking as you do the ride over the next few hours?
Well, on my bike, I have a bottle of water and a bottle of Gatorade. Probably fill up every time we go to
every
the rest
every time there's
stop.
A rest stop, right?
Yeah.
That can't be it. There's got to be. You got to eat something, you know?
Yeah. Probably could eat a lot of pickles. And
yeah. Dad, what do you say about that menu item?
Pretty much whatever I give him, he's probably going to eat. You know, salty foods are really good for him. Just retain the water for...
Hence the pickles.
Correct there.
Understood.
But, yeah, I mean, Yudi's got a very good story why he got into... Besides wanting to do Bike for Chai for the sake of the ride itself and being... I would like to say being together with his father, and we spent some amazing time.
I can imagine.
This past 3 months just training.
Hundreds of miles.
Hundreds of miles. Yeah, Yudi. I mean, being from Detroit, he's an avid hockey player, and he's been playing hockey since he's been 3 years old. So he actually took off. He decided last year that he wanted to take off a year of hockey. He wanted to put his full effort into training over the course of the winter, and we got him a bike, put him on the trainer, and off he went. And he's been off of hockey for about 6 months now, but he's loving this, and it's for a great cause.
What do your teammates think? Your hockey mates? They think you're crazy?
Yeah.
They do think you're nuts.
But you want to tell Nachum about
I
why?
I have a friend in my class that he has trouble walking, so he said he's hopefully in Rosh Hashanah going to be at Camp Simcha at the finish line.
Holy cow.
He's a camper this year. He's a camper, I believe, for the first time this year. And so it was very special for Yudi not only to ride together here, but also to eventually hopefully meet him at the finish line and doing something that's good for a classmate of his.
What's that reunion going to be like? Pretty cool, no?
It should be amazing.
I can only imagine. Well, I wish you both good luck. Neil Single and Yudi Single, father and son from Detroit, who are riding in Bike for Chai, getting ready in just a few minutes to head to the start line as the excitement builds over here. And we point out again that Yudi is just 13 years old and setting quite an example for those who wonder whether somebody as young as you could do this thing.
Just
yes.
Let me set the record straight that the reason why Yudi is allowed to ride when he's 13 years old is because he's being accompanied by myself.
Right, understood.
Otherwise
they wouldn't allow it.
Correct.
How'd the fundraising go, by the way, for the two of you? A lot of good response?
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, Yudi. Who can say no to a face like this?
Simple as that. Huh? He asks, they're going to answer. Good luck, gentlemen.
We appreciate it. Thank you so much.
We'll be rooting for you, and we look forward to seeing you at camp. When we arrive there, that'll be Thursday. We'll be there at, Dr. Ginsburg is here. Dr. Ari Ginsburg of Beit Shemesh.
In the flesh.
We want you over here. We want you closer to me, Dr. Ginsburg.
I'm always happy to be here the day after the Yankees lose to the Mets.
I didn't even know that happened, frankly.
Quite badly.
Imagine that.
I actually heard a rumor that Frank Cashman traded you for a number of prospects in over the last 24 hours.
Oh, is that what you heard?
That's what I heard.
Or was it Brian?
It was Brian Cashman.
Oh, yeah. There you go. I think you confused Frank Cashman with Brian
Cashman.
No,
I said Brian.
Did you? Anyway, Rabbi Ginsburg, or I should say Dr. Ginsburg,
you
not to confuse
things.
In all seriousness, and we have to be serious for a moment, It's unbelievable. Number one, you're riding and you're living thousands of miles away in Israel. So you timed your schedule to be in the United States, obviously, around Bike for Chai. Number two, you are an oncologist. You are somebody who is on a daily basis associated with and dealing with situations that are very common to the people at Chai Lifeline. And I mean this as much as we love seeing each other and joking around. That's a completely serious comment. And you take the vocation very seriously, obviously. And thirdly, you love doing this just to help Chai Lifeline any way possible.
When your personal life and your professional life are able to get together in a way like this, on a day like this, and biking up to the camp and doing the preparation work for it, and you get there, it's just a very special thing. And yes, it's a special thing for everybody, and for me, I get the professional overlap, which it's special. What they do is unbelievable.
Yeah, like I say, you see it up close and personal on a daily basis. Well, good luck today. You'll be on the road for how long today?
Usually get in around 3-ish in that neck of the woods.
You're one of those pros.
Nah.
You're not on the road till midnight.
My friend Sam out there is one of those pros.
Yeah, he'll be there, 1 o'clock?
I have to say hello to your biggest fan, Judy Goldring, my mother-in-law, while I'm here. If I don't, I'll be in a lot of trouble when I get home.
Well, send her our best.
Thanks, everybody.
Dr. Ari Ginsburg, everybody, who promised us that he would be here at Bike for Chai, and he kept his word. Moshe Aditya Blass is with us. He has the record for the longest commute to Bike for Chai. He is here from Israel. He has a brother who had a liver transplant.
Two
liver transplants.
He had one at the age of 9 months. He was born with biliary atresia. And at the age of 9 months, he had a liver transplant. And then it kind of relapsed about 4 years later. And he had a second one a year ago in Lag BaOmer.
What made you come all this way to ride with Bike for Chai?
Well, I have an enormous amount of Hakar Satov to Chai Lifeline.
I can only imagine.
Yeah, they were in Children's Hospital of Philadelphia with, I think they were there for the first time about 4 months. The second time they were in and out of the hospital for a year and a half before the transplant, and then for a couple months after the transplant. They received an enormous amount of help from Chai Lifeline when your family's, 6,000 miles away. So, of course, any help is very appreciated. And the amount that Chai Lifeline gave is enormous. Just want to give a shout out to Rabbi Shirley Fried of Bike for Chai and Naomi Stavsky, who were very involved with the care. And they still are in touch with us about it.
It may be hard to believe, but there are some people who are not as familiar with some of the things Chai Lifeline does.
Hard to believe.
It is hard to believe, but in many ways, if people aren't touched by it and are not that familiar with it, they may not know. Can you give us a couple of details, things that they do for families that come in so handy and are so supportive when they're going through a situation like you described?
In a nutshell, I can say what personally happened at Children's Hospital in Philadelphia and what I know happens in a lot of other hospitals. Food on a daily basis was brought, good nourishing food, home-cooked food, not your standard hospital meals, which between you and me are not the best.
Yeah, so
there was a room called the Kosher Pantry, stocked full with all sorts of kosher food. There's the Chai Lifeline House. I know there's one in Philadelphia by Children's Hospital or by the main hospital. There's one in Baltimore, which is pretty much a place where if you're staying in the hospital and a family member comes to visit overnight, they can stay there. What else? All sorts of gifts. My brother still has a stuffed animal collection from when he was in the hospital the first time and the second time. Gifts, volunteers to watch my brother when my parents were busy with all sorts of things so they could take care of things, so they could rest a little.
It's endless, huh?
Yeah.
It really is endless.
It's beyond endless. I know other people who have been touched by High Lifeline. In Ramat Beit Shemesh, there's another rider who's here also, Zalmi Levi. His brother is a counselor in Simcha and Simcha Special. He's a camper. His name is Laser. He was burned in a fire maybe 4 years ago. He lost both legs, one arm, and the other arm is extremely deformed in a wheelchair. He has, I think, prosthetic legs, but they're very uncomfortable, so he doesn't like to use them. And I've seen pictures of Laser before he was introduced to High Lifeline Camp Simcha, and I met him just this year, and he's a completely different person. Before he was, you can expect what he's like, you know, miserable kid, you know, what enjoyment does a kid have in life if he's not running around and playing? And here he is stuck, confined to a wheelchair, to a bed, and now you bring him to Camp Simcha, and he feels like a normal kid. He runs around in a wheelchair, but the counselors make him feel, you know, like there's nothing different about him. He has tremendous amounts of fun. I've spent Shabbos with him at the Levi's house, and we take him to parks, and he's become a completely different person.
Unbelievable. The whole thing is unbelievable. You do most of your training in Israel, I assume,
yeah,
right? What's that like?
It's interesting. The driver,
biking the Holy Land, huh?
Yes, the drivers are definitely, I don't want to say dibasarets, but you can guess what the drivers are like. Try driving.
So I've heard.
Try riding on the Cross Bronx Expressway, and you'll know what an Israeli driver is like. It's very hilly terrain, as you can say. Beit Shemesh is a very hilly area,
right.
So that's what everyone was telling me. Oh, you're riding in Beit Shemesh. Great, you'll be fully prepared for the ride.
Right.
I never got to 7,500 feet of elevation or 110 miles. My top ride was 80 miles with about 4,000 feet of elevation.
How long will you be on the road today?
My estimate is somewhere between 8 and 10 hours.
Very nice. Amazing. Incredible commitment. And if anybody wants to look up any of the riders, Moshe Bless or any of the others, you can do so online. They can donate to Bike for Chai at bikeforchai.com. Yes?
I just want to shout out to my father, my brother, and my grandparents. My grandparents who hosted my father and brother, or my mother and brother, when they were here for treatments and are now hosting me. And my grandmother said she's going to be listening.
There you go.
And to my father and my brother, who they have to come now to CHOP every year, half a year or so, for checkups, and they timed it so that they would come now and be at the finish line.
Oh, phenomenal. So you'll see them tomorrow.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, both of you. Amazing. And anybody out there who wants to donate and be part of this incredible effort, go to bikeforchai.com, bike4chai.com, and you can participate. Jonathan Tesler is with us. He is involved, I am told, in the cycling world, editor of Bicycle.net, the leading cycling blog. It's his first year with Bike for Chai. Jonathan Tesler, welcome to JM in the AM.
Thank you very much. Glad to be here.
How does one become the editor of Bicycle.net?
Get lucky and get a domain name really early and turn your hobby into something that kind of looks like a business.
What is it about cycling? If you had to explain to people who don't normally hit the road with the two-wheeler, what is it about bicycling and cycling that makes this such an attraction for so many?
I think a lot of people will say the same thing, that when you get back on a bike later in life, it kind of brings you back to when you're a kid. And that feeling of you get your first two-wheeler, and it's like this feeling of freedom. You got to go to your friend's house that was four blocks away without your parents. And I think it kind of...
Real independence.
Yeah, it helps you relive that childhood, I think, a little
Interesting.
Bit.
Interesting. And that just that feeling just stays with you through these hundreds and hundreds of miles. Huh?
Absolutely.
And you hit the open road, and you just enjoy every minute of it.
Yeah, you get to go places that you normally wouldn't go. And if you're sitting in a car with your insulated closed windows, you miss a lot. And when you're on the bike, you're really part of the landscape, and you get to see a lot more than you would normally.
What is nature like out there for those of us who don't see it face to face like you do on a regular basis?
Sometimes it's very spiritual, at least for me. I have a very spiritual connection to it when I'm on the bike. Sometimes it can just be excruciatingly hard and you can suffer out there. But in the end, you have a destination And there's this huge amount of accomplishment when you get there, and just being surrounded by it can push you through some very, very long hard rides.
You do most of your riding locally, around where you live, or you travel the world?
So most of my riding has been local. I live in Southern California, and I have some of those beautiful and diverse landscape in the world, maybe. But I have traveled for cycling. But I always come back home. Beautiful. I got Pacific Coast Highway in my backyard.
Oh, my gosh. That must be amazing on a bike.
It's gorgeous.
How does this rank? How does this route rank when it comes to experiences on a bicycle?
Well, it's different in the sense that if you're talking about like the difficulty of the route. The route itself, I mean, for the distance, isn't that difficult in the sense that you don't have a lot of like vertical feet all at one time. The rolling terrain can really wear you over time.
Right.
Because it's either going up or down, and there's really no rhythm that you get into.
Seems to be the theme among all the riders.
Yeah. I would think so.
That it is an up and down type of ride for today. How long will you be on the road today? How long will it take you to do the 110 miles?
It's a great question. It just depends on...
Well, I'm wondering if someone like you is going to do this at a really leisurely pace, if you're going to stay back and, you know, try to experience with other people all that they're going through as they do this ride, or you're just, you know, you're ready to get there as soon and as fast as possible.
It's always the plan.
It's always the plan.
It's always the plan to take a step back and really enjoy the, you know, be involved in the atmosphere of the ride, but it always happens that I have some friends here, I know some good riders are here, and you're a little bit of a marked man.
So, competitive nature, huh?
It just kicks in.
So you'll be in the hotel by noon.
I expect I'll be done near the front of the groups.
Yeah, I can only imagine. Why High Lifeline? Why this ride for the very first time?
So it's a great question. I was actually somewhat resistant to come. For the only reason is just so far from home. It's an airplane ride to and from, time off of work, which is a premium. But I have friends that have done the ride multiple years, and every time they come back, they're just raving about it. And it's the ride. You have to do it. So I actually spent the time last year to look at the photos, to look at some videos, and I went, wow. Right? I've done a lot of charity rides, a lot of crazy long, brutal types of climb, but nothing with the atmosphere that I saw in the photos.
Right.
So now that I'm here, I get it. It's obvious.
Oh, and there's plenty more coming up, especially as you get up to camp.
If all you did was come just to see this, that is amazing in itself.
Unbelievable. Jonathan Tesler, he is editor of Bicycle.net, the great cycling blog. It's his first year with Bike for Chai. We wish you the best of luck. No matter how fast you want to do this route, we wish you the best of luck, and we'll see you up in camp tomorrow.
I'll see you in camp for sure.
What will be the world's greatest finish line, as they say.
And I can't wait to be there.
Thank you, Jonathan.
Thank you.
JM in the AM on this Wednesday as we start to see some of the riders. I don't know if ZK wants to point in that direction yet or not, but some of the riders have already begun to line up. Some of them have already begun to take their place. There you go. That's what the start line looks like here at the Crown Plaza in Stamford, Connecticut. And this two-day adventure will conclude up at camp. We'll start tomorrow at about 1:45 Eastern time with coverage from Camp Simcha, and you'll have an opportunity to hear our report from there as the riders get to camp. I also remind you that JM and the AM in our 3 weeks format features Keep Alive tomorrow morning, a live a cappella group that will be doing a performance in studio for us at JM and the AM when we're back in studio tomorrow on Thursday morning. Assemblyman Phil Goldfeder is here. He is he's riding. He's getting ready for another one of these Bike for Chais. He's actually retiring from the New York State Assembly in the very near future. Good morning to you, Assemblyman. How are you, sir?
I'm good. It's good to see you here.
Some of us are sad to see you leave the position of New York State Assemblyman.
I'm told some aren't as sad, my wife being one of them.
She's thrilled, huh?
She is thrilled with this decision.
And we've already announced the intention for Mr. Goldfeder, where you're going
to
be next.
Already announced. I'm very excited to be starting at Yeshiva University in the fall, heading up the government relations operation there. So I'm excited. A really great group of people, an amazing institution, and I'm excited to join that team.
We are big Yeshiva University fans, as you know, so we wish you the best of luck. It's an amazing place, and we're sure your experience up there will be amazing in and of itself. I want to remind everybody, you can watch us on video right now. If you go to NachumSiegel.com, you can watch the video of this entire Bike for Chai presentation. Well, the excitement's building. As you sit here with me, we see more and more riders showing up to the start line and all the announcements being made and the DJ going nuts and this whole excitement, which I guess you've been preparing for months.
For months and months. And I'll tell you, as much as you prepare, you can't possibly prepare yourself for what you're feeling right now. Literally minutes before you're about to get on the road, even closer to the finish line. And I don't say that because it's exciting to finish 180 miles, but the sheer enjoyment and excitement of coming in and seeing the campers and just the look on their face makes the entire months and months of training, the entire 180 miles worth it.
What year is this for you?
This is my second year.
Second year. So how did the fundraising go this year? Did Team Goldfeder do well in that department?
We're still pushing. We did okay, but we could definitely do better. So if anybody is up on the website, feel free to go to Phil Goldfeder's page and help us out. But this is an entire operation that is so well done, which is a testament to how the kids get to spend their summers. I mean, right. Every detail is looked after, and so I can only imagine that the kids that go to this camp obviously need all the fundraising that's been done, but the attention to detail for us, I can only imagine what goes into the campers.
You know, one of the frustrating things, I'm sure, for someone like yourself who's spent all this time in government is when you hear from the community, and you sometimes get frustrated that people who are vocal about things the way they are in the community don't get involved. Then you come here last night, and you see just the opposite. You see hundreds of people and each and every one of their support systems who have gotten involved, who are trying to make a difference, who are trying to do something really benevolent and noble, and you get to be part of it.
This is more than just a bike ride. This is, it draws people in. The energy, the excitement, the passion, it draws people in. You know, I'm excited to say that I was, when I heard about this ride a few years ago, when I first got elected, as any politician would, you see a big gathering of people, you want to go and say hello. And so about 5 years ago, one of the first rides, I went to one of the rest stops just to shake hands. And nobody wanted to shake hands with me. Everybody was preoccupied with what was going on. And I said, if they're too busy to want to shake my hand, it must be something exciting. And so last year I decided I was going to see for it myself. Like you said, I wasn't going to sit on the sidelines. I wanted to be a part of it. And so last year I rode. It was so exciting. This year it wasn't even a question. This has been an amazing couple of months leading up to today. And like I said, I can't wait for tomorrow night.
Yeah, tomorrow's amazing. The finish line is incredible. And the support, they're close to, at this point, I don't have the exact figure in front of me, but I think it's close to $7 million, which is an amazing accomplishment.
In working with the Bike for Chai team, some permitting issues, anytime I would talk to a government agency or trying to clear out some bureaucracy, I said, take a look what they're able to accomplish. I said, I don't care what organization you talk about, but in one event, be able to raise this much money, and not just as much money, but think about how many people contributed. We're in political season, right? So we keep hearing from presidential candidates, not just how much money, but how many people have contributed.
Right.
I would dare them both to take a look at how many people have contributed to this campaign, to Bike for Chai, to Chai Lifeline, to the amazing campers.
It's in the tens of thousands, and it's really amazing. So once you leave office, do we get to bring you back and hear some of the inside stories about what really goes on and how the government works or doesn't work?
I look forward to coming back for as many times as you'll have me. Not sure what you'll get out of me quite yet, but we'll see.
Phil Goldfeder, he's a wonderful assemblyman. He moves on to Yeshiva University in September, I assume?
November. We're still working out the details.
At some point. Good luck today.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much.
He's anticipating being at this start line in just a couple of minutes. The start line is building. If you're watching on video right now at NachumSiegel.com, you'll see exactly what's going on as more and more people line up in their Bike for Chai uniforms with all their equipment. I'll tell you, Miriam Wallach's here, and I took a photo with one of the riders earlier when it was just the two of us at the start line, and he had gel packs and bananas and all these different falling out of every pocket, trying to be as conserve as best as possible in terms of space, but have as much as necessary to to make it through the ride.
Well, I noticed that their gloves have spots for gel packs.
Are you serious?
On the inside, yeah. It says gel.
Let me see that for a moment. Unbelievable. There you go.
Yeah,
incredible.
It's pretty wild. It's pretty wild. But we got to get these two guys
on. All right, who do we have here?
We have AB and Jack.
AB and Jack are representing a team that we spoke about last evening in the early part of this JM and the AM broadcast. Jack Dweck is a team cyclist member. That's SY cyclist member. As we pointed out, the team is made up of people from the Syrian community. Many of them have been riding for years. It's Jack's second year, and he's a member of the Double High Club. We say congratulations on that. Triple High. I'll tell you, but they print this, and then by the time it happens, you're already a Triple High. And then AB Mal is with us, one of the first Bike for Hires, the seventh year cycling. Well, and he is a member of Team Cyclist as well and a member of the Triple High Club. Good morning to you as well.
Good morning.
So 7 years means when you first did this, how many people were with you?
We had 37 riders, and we raised $200,000.
Unbelievable. Was it a much lonelier ride up to camp back then?
No, it was still tough, but it wasn't what it is today. Yoli is bent on punishment, so he's found all the hills from here all the way up.
Yeah, in reference to the Yoel Margulies.
Yes, Yoel Margulies.
Yeah, and he's a big hill guy. He likes the ups and downs of this thing.
Yeah, he just likes to punish people, so yeah. I think he's doing a good job.
Unbelievable. When you first got together with Team Cyclist and you had this whole idea of getting a representation from the Syrian community, what was the reception like? Were people?
No, the truth is we hesitated for many years because we felt that if we do a team, that if one guy's raising a lot of money, the other ones might not feel the responsibility, the pressure. But these guys were just insane. It was every day, every minute. There was another email. I think they beat up old ladies on the street for money. I don't know what they did, but every minute there was another text. You got another donation. So my hat's off to them for making the team. And it's just been an incredible ride even before we started.
Unbelievable. What's it like riding for High Lifeline, knowing the cause as you do these 180 miles?
When they say it's the greatest finish line in the world, I have to say that it really is the greatest finish line in the world. There's absolutely nothing like it. And once you get bit by the Bike for High bug, there's no turning around. There's no going back. It's an incredible experience, and I mean, it's an incredible charity. What they do is just absolutely amazing. This year is very personal for me.
Because?
A very good friend of mine's daughter was just in the camp. Baruch Hashem, she's doing very well now, and she's expected to make a full recovery. But I just want to wish everybody out there, and I want to wish Norma a full refuah shleiman, and we hope that she gets back to herself.
It's incredible we've heard about how the camp just invigorates these kids and gives them so much that they wouldn't get it under any other circumstances.
As soon as we pull in, every camper, every counselor, every doctor, every maintenance, every crew, everybody's waiting, and the excitement just brings tears to your eyes. You can't help but break down.
Jack Dweck, AB Mallow with us, about to get to the start line here and begin Bike for High. What are you carrying with you? Tell us about the different accoutrements
I'm carrying twins.
He's carrying twins.
I'm almost there. But
you got plenty of food, plenty of drink.
No, I don't need to because this is the best. I've traveled the world biking. Holland, Sicily, you name it, I've been there. Israel, I did a few times, Berlin. There's no ride that's maintained like this in the world. Yoli and the guys and the staff and the girls do maybe the best job I've ever seen in my life. I've done 20 rides, 30 rides, and there's nothing like it. And
At every rest stop, you'll be fully hydrated.
Everything you can think of is taken care of. So there is. These guys are the true professionals of a ride. Every ride I've been on, there's nothing like this. And he was mentioning that he's riding for someone. We started this ride with a good friend of mine, Alan Shama, who this year was stricken with a bit of a scare with cancer, but he overcame it, got a clean bill of health. He's out here riding. We love him. He's going to get 100% better.
Wow.
And that's what it's all about.
Unbelievable. What do you think of this, the starting line, and all the energy and anticipation that's building as we look at this scene?
I just have to say, I couldn't sleep last night with all the excitement and anticipation that was building up. It's really an incredible thing. I mean, the starting line, 500 riders this year. It's an incredible thing. And the amount of money that they raised, more than anything else. I think we're at $6.6 million.
I know, it's unbelievable.
Which is absolutely incredible.
I just want to end it with a story because I know you're busy. I met someone last week who goes to Penn State. So she says, oh, we did a fundraiser. Very nice, that's beautiful. I says, how much is raised? She says, $8 million. Wow, that's wonderful. I said, how many people were participating? She says, 15,000. We're 500 and we're at 7 million.
Unbelievable.
15,000, 8 million. I think we're doing pretty good.
You are
number
doing
one fundraising per rider event in the country and maybe the world.
Unbelievable. AB Mala, Jack Dweck, thank congratulations.
I just want to say thank you 1 second to the 260 people that sponsored my ride this year. It's an incredible number.
Now we know why you're a triple
it's
260 high, huh?
60 people. It's not a lot of big donations, but everybody with, you know, the hundreds and the 50s, a few thousands and a few 1800s as well. But I just want to really give a shout out to all my friends who really came through for this wonderful organization.
We just to finish up, this year we have 7,000 new contributors.
Wow.
So the diversification is great. The money's coming in little by little. Like I said, everybody's coming in. So 7,000 new people have contributed and more money. So kol hakavod to everybody here. We love you. Thank you for coming.
Thank you so
much.
We'll
see you next year.
Good luck. Enjoy the ride.
We don't get a t-shirt. No, I'm kidding.
Of course you can have a t-shirt.
Good luck.
Oh, yes. Here we are on a JM in the AM Wednesday, and this is Bike for Chai. ZK is turning the camera. You can see it at NachumSiegel.com as we continue here with the start line. They traditionally begin with a ribbon cutting ceremony and with Tfilas HaDerech, which I assume is going to be coming up soon. In real time, we're literally 5-10 minutes away from this. What is it? Yes, Miriam Wallach, you have a report for us.
You. They'll be doing the national anthem as well, they just announced.
Is the rumor true that Yankee Lemmer's doing the national anthem? Is the rumor true that Yankee Lemmer's doing the national anthem?
Well, for as much as I can hear, as there's a lot of good noise, as you can imagine, going on here. Yankee Lemmer was just announced. The words national anthem were announced. I'm sure we could do small math, but I can't hear anything for sure.
I believe Yankee, who I also believe is riding. I think he's riding.
He is riding? Did we see him last night?
Yeah, I think he's riding, and I think that...
I know, last night's a bit of a blur.
That he's going to be singing the national anthem.
Okay, so I just want you to know that this completely lives up to the hype of last year. All that I heard about, all that I was told about, all that I felt that I missed out on, completely there.
You know, it's funny, maybe funny is the wrong word. Every one of these riders, and ZK has the camera now for people to see at NachumSiegel.com on the riders. Every one of these riders, every one of them is carrying on their shoulders an incredible group of people who've supported them, an amazing family that's been a support system for them, contributors who want to see them succeed and want to see them get to camp safely and get to camp and just accomplish this incredible 180 miles. And I think they feel it. I think they feel it. I think they feel that they're carrying with them their entire team, that they're carrying with them all this spirit and energy that they've been building up with all this training over all these months.
I think that they realize that this ride is so much bigger than them. What they are involved in is so much more than just the individual. And that's what's going on here. And it's one thing to be part of an event where you're working towards a cause, but this is a mission. This is a mission. They are literally and figuratively driven towards this goal. And I am palpably excited for tomorrow. I can't even imagine what that is like. You and I are not finishing anything tomorrow, but I can't wait to be at that finish line.
It is an incredible experience. And we heard earlier that this is arguably the largest cycling fundraiser in the entire country and maybe the world. It's just incredible to me how in such a short period of time this has happened. And it is the passion and the drive, as you say, of every one of these people that has made that happen. And as you see now, one of the youngsters who's in a wheelchair is being surrounded by all this love
and all this incredible and wonderful outpouring. A celebration is taking place as we speak.
Unreal. That's Joey, by the way. That's Joey. We were introduced to him last night. He has the most infectious smile. Unbelievable. He's such a chayin, and everyone's rallying around him. And these, like we mentioned at the beginning of this morning's program, that even the Tour de France participants who are here were taking pictures with him last night. He was the star, and that's also part of it. But you know what's interesting? When you had on just Jack and Avi just a few moments ago, and they're talking about the growth of Bike for Chai and the success of Bike for Chai, the pride that they personally take in that growth is tremendous. And I think that you can say that effectively about every single person who's here. They are all so proud of not only being a part of this, but of the tremendous growth of this young program, this young race that has grown so exponentially, and it serves as a paradigm for other events like this around the world. It's tremendous.
And it's grown so quickly. And what did you think of Jesse Rotberg when he was with us?
Oh, my word.
Who refused to get into any conversation regarding the competition or the goals that are set, in this case 110 miles in day one.
Yeah.
He simply said, I'm hitting the road and I'm going to do my ride.
It was unbelievable. And he also refused to engage in any negative conversation.
Right.
Anytime you asked him about the naysayers, he wouldn't go there. Anytime you asked him about things that...
Yeah, hurdles and challenges.
Exactly, impediments or challenges or whatever. Nope, not going there. Not going there. He is so in that frame of mind. And I know you were concentrating for good reason on the interview, but seeing his wife sitting there, standing there, taking video of the entire interview, shepping such Nacha, so proud of her husband. I mean, he's a true role model. He's a true hero.
Unbelievable. Yeah. A real role model, a real hero, and somebody.
We're going to the national anthem.
Oh, are we going to the national anthem?
Yeah, we have a mic, and we're
right.
Going to the national anthem.
Why not? All great events start with the national anthem.
Go to the PA.
We should be able to pick it up. And it is, in fact, the Yankee Lemmer, of course, as we suspected.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land.
It may be 8:45 JM in the AM time, but it is not 8:45 here Wednesday morning. And anyone who's living in those homes over there, I'm sure they're up now.
They certainly are after that rendition. You know, we keep focusing on the front of this pack. Look how far back it goes. There are four or five groups of probably 100 each that are getting set to start this ride. And this whole group that's in front of us right now is going to collectively take off at some point very, very soon. And then right after that, the next group's going to move up. They're going to do the same thing about a minute later. And then about 5 minutes later, they'll all be on the road and all be heading up to Camp Simcha.
They're asking the traditional, are you ready? So I guess.
I don't know. They've been ready for 6 months, these guys. But what's fantastic, by the way, is that I can't recognize anyone. Helmets, sunglasses on, no matter what. But then there's Alan Von Grant.
Well,
1 second.
Kol ro'enu ki ata avinu shomea barachamim tefilot amcha Israel betachnunim baruch shomea hatefila.
Okay, I need everybody over here who's not writing.
That
please
is,
move out of the way.
One deep and meaningful tefillah.
Yeah, Hadzara. You could say that again.
These guys are on a journey. They're on a mission, and it's way beyond 190 miles.
You pray for everyone's safety and everyone to make it through the ride without any. Any injuries, any health problems, right. Or any obstacles, and any equipment problems, that is a true, meaningful Tfilas HaDerech, the traveler's prayer.
I was joking before that I can't recognize anyone, but you can see Alan Weingrad.
Yeah.
Above everyone else. He's the only one I can pick out of a crowd. Exactly. Is that how you feel all the time?
No, I feel like you're reusing your material here.
Did I say that already?
Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
You said that a minute ago on the air.
I lost track.
My, oh, my.
Oh, my gosh.
For those of you concerned about Miriam Wallach, I guess there's reason to be concerned.
Okay.
All right, so here we go. This is literally the countdown.
Not to be believed.
Take a look at the video, everybody. There they go. Take a look at the video. They've already started. Take a look at the video as they break the ribbon and proceed from the Crowne Plaza Hotel in Stamford, Connecticut to stop number one. And then stop number two, 180 miles from now, is going to be Camp Simcha, where we will be on Thursday afternoon. You'll be able to see it and hear it with us at NahumSiegel.com starting at about 1:45 Thursday afternoon Eastern Time. And as you see now, this group will complete its initial part of this journey, leaving the hotel. And then the second group is going to move up and do the very same thing. And that is how Bike for Chai works. Very organized, I must say.
Very organized.
Very organized. How are we doing on time there, ZK? What are we up to?
We're doing just fine on time.
All right?
We should just keep in mind, by the way, that a lot of what's going on now is completely about safety. The spacing out of the cyclists, making sure everyone has enough room to
get
going.
Good luck, everybody! There they go. The singles were in that group I just saw.
I also just want to mention that even before we got started yesterday, Yoni and I got here around 4:45. If there was any chaos, it was not evident to anyone. The vibe in the hotel by 4:45 yesterday was not to be believed. It is obviously exponentially greater now.
It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
I don't want to speak over the countdown. It's like almost a shame.
It is unbelievable.
But it is such a production. It is so professional that if anything is going wrong, and usually we are in on anything that is going wrong, we are in the know. We know nothing. It is so well done.
I like the stylish bicycle helmets, and it's nice to see people in our community taking safety seriously enough to make sure to have their helmets.
Well, Michael Fragan is the perfect example of somebody who just appreciated his bicycle helmet. And
we don't know where he'd be without his helmet.
Absolutely, and we thank God that he is well, but he has mentioned to me, he doesn't understand people who bike without a helmet.
You gotta
be nuts.
Based on his experience, I understand that. Bike for Chai start line is now up to group number four. This goes very quickly. In just a few minutes, it's going to be a pretty silent area over here, and the excitement that we're experiencing here is not going to be with us anymore. But this energy, this incredible rush that we are getting and everybody's getting, especially the riders,
right,
throughout this entire process is just incredible. And all these hours and all these days and all these weeks of the training and the commitment and all the different weather circumstances and all the different personal circumstances that people go through to make sure to keep that training going. It all culminates with this unbelievable moment.
ZK, by the way, is doing his best to give us the most phenomenal shot possible. It's a little hard in between the bystanders and the participants.
Here they come, ZK. Here they come.
But a shout out to ZK, who's certainly doing a yeoman's job here this morning.
This is group number 5. It may even be the final group. That's now approaching the start line and heading up to Camp Simcha. Anybody who wants to contribute to Bike for Chai, you can go to the website, bikenumber4chai.com, bikenumber4chai.com, and you can...
Yeah, donations are certainly still being accepted.
Oh, yes.
I'm not sure everyone has reached their financial obligations in terms of commitment. So if you are inspired by this morning's broadcast, if you are inspired not to ride but to give... Please do so.
I find it intriguing, some of the bicycle equipment. A lot of people have these rear view mirrors as part of their bicycle helmets.
Well, I think what's interesting is that a new piece of equipment is the GoPro. Mayor Kruder is
nice.
GoPro-ing his ride.
Nice.
So it's not just about safety. It's about getting the entire experience and making sure that you have your own, almost like your own yearbook, your own history, your own sharing to do. Look at these guys. And by the way, note how cool the bicycles are.
Yeah.
I mean, you got your orange, you got the, some, there was another guy who had one that was bright blue and
a
each
neon
tire.
Bicycle.
Oh, yeah. This guy with his pink socks. I mean, it's so cool what's going on here this morning.
That's one of the ways you can, that one can distinguish themselves
right
by the way they dress up themselves and their equipment. That's for sure.
I also love, by the way, right, there's that personalization.
Yeah.
And you can see how much, I mean, we just watched guys just, you know, with their own wheel kits, making sure that the last thing is tightened and whatever. I'm just happy when my shoelaces are not untied in the middle of a race. They have so much to worry about, the logistics of this. And we should note the mascots. We have mascots.
Yeah.
I have no idea what animal that is.
Well, I guess the mascots are there just to celebrate with everybody.
And yes.
And to provide even more joy at this joyous occasion.
Hundreds of volunteers part of making this a success. The commitment of all the riders, the commitment of everyone at Bike for Chai. I mean, when we were told originally by Rabbi Scholar last summer that he's not the person we're going to be. I'm like, how is it possible that there's a whole nother division
right.
that they take care of this? But you can't not. This
yeah.
requires its own team.
When you're the country's largest charity ride, it needs its own team. And sure enough.
Ah, and then we have JJ.
We got JJ on the hand cycle. Is that the proper term?
I think so.
Right?
I think so. Yeah, we have a photograph of that. We have a shot of that. Jamie will be posting that on social media. Lines up with all the other bikes in the bike hold. Unbelievable. Riders of all from all differing backgrounds.
And
parents who are riding.
And you wonder about the motivation, especially for somebody who needs a specialized cycle like that.
Right.
You wonder about the motivation and what keeps them going. And they have a goal. They have a goal to achieve. And they want to see it through. And it's like anything else in life. They want to, you know, make sure to achieve that goal, to do it in as best and as incredible a way as possible. And sure enough, he and all these other riders are doing just that.
Right. It's...
And that's it. I think every rider has now left the area. Yeah. SAG 38 is ready to...
So now we see the SAG teams. And we have learned... there's one more. One more rider.
There we go.
We have learned that SAG is a verb, to yeah. SAG. SAG is a noun and SAG is a verb. That is.
And they accompany the
safety and gear. Is that what we learned that it
yeah,
stands for?
And they accompany the riders and they make sure to be there for any situation, whether it's personal, God forbid any type of injury, or if it's equipment, anything that happens to the bicycle, they make sure to be there and help out as best as they can. I was also thrilled to hear by somebody who was sitting in that chair a few minutes ago, who rides around the world and tells us
right.
that there's no reason for him to have food and or drink
that
with him.
That was unbelievable.
Because the rest areas are so well stocked
right.
and so well taken care of
right.
that there's nothing for them to worry about, which is unbelievable. What a testament to Bike for Chai that they're able to do that and live up to that incredible reputation that they have.
Yeah, it just it satisfies me as the Jewish mother. So what are they going to eat? No, they're taken care of.
I still think one of the funniest things I saw was all the food and drink hanging out of somebody's bicycle uniform.
For sure.
As they were getting ready.
One thing that we didn't ask is, what are these guys listening to as they are riding?
Good point.
And a lot of them, I noticed they have the iPhones, they have patches on their arms.
Oh, I guess the answer is the NSN app.
I imagine they're listening to JM and AM as they head up. So they are listening to the conclusion of hour one, which we did last night. And
what time is it now? Oh my gosh.
Wow. It's unbelievable.
Earlier than I suspected.
It is unbelievable.
Just a few minutes to go here as we wrap up a Wednesday. A reminder that we have a performance in studio at JM and the AM that's going to be on Thursday morning tomorrow. And that is we're going to wrap up the 3 weeks format before we get to the 9 days with an a cappella live performance. Could you imagine?
It's a nice job.
Even our 3 weeks format, which people think is could be slow and boring, we end up with a bang. Could you imagine with a live performance in studio?
And then the conclusion of the race, of the ride.
The ride, about 1:45 tomorrow Eastern time. We'll start after the stunt show. We'll start a webcasting from up in camp. And you'll be able to see and hear what we see and hear as the world's greatest finish line lives up to its reputation. And all these hundreds of riders get to camp. Talk about celebration. If we think this was a celebration, that's going to be a much, much bigger and even more meaningful celebration when the campers at Camp Simcha are there to greet all these riders.
Right.
That's going to be pretty cool.
I can't wait. And by the way, we have participants. We have women who were in the women's ride, the Tour de Simcha, who are here showing their support for the men who are riding today.
Very nice. So Tour de Simcha took place a month or two ago, right?
I think it was
month ago.
It was the last month, right?
And we congratulate them who made sure to make an honorary commitment to Chai Lifeline. Something that our listeners can do very easily. You can go to the Bike for Chai website, and you could see how the world's greatest charity ride continues to raise money to help families and children in life-threatening situations, in difficult medical situations. The stories we've heard this time and the stories we get to listen to and tell throughout the entire year reminds everybody just how important an organization this is, just how important Chai Lifeline is to our community and to every segment of our community.
I mean...
there you go.
Thank you. And that's why we have ZK.
That's why we have ZK, because right. He solved that in a moment.
That was such a ZK moment.
It certainly was. I wish we had that on video. A shout out to the medical teams, the Hatzalah members, right. All the different people that are on the route, the volunteers at the rest areas, the hundreds of people that have volunteered to make this ride what it is, because we've spoken to a lot of the organizers and spoken to people who are on the front lines. But it is, as Yoel Margulies, as he steps in for a second, can attest to, there is nothing. We have 30 seconds, Yoel. Help me thank all those volunteers that have made this Bike for Chai ride what it is.
I could definitely tell you that we have 500 riders, we have 320 volunteers this year. Without that, this would not have happened.
Unbelievable.
At all. Every single one of them.
Thank you, y'all. Great seeing you. We did do the Bike for Chai anthem earlier, so all the references to you were on the air. I can tell you that much. Achenu b'Yisrael and Achim Achem, our brothers and sisters in Israel, we are with you. It's your favorite America's one and only Jewish Moments in the Morning radio program. Heard on listener sponsored WFMU East Orange, WMFU Mount Hope, Rockland County at 91.9 on the FM dial, around the world on the web, jmn.org. And I thank our entire staff, ZK and Stan, and our engineering department, and of course, Jamie Turkel and Yoni Pollack, Miriam L. Wallach, of course, and the entire team of Rumi Finkelstein. Stay tuned for another great day on our stream at jmn.org. And I thank everybody for listening in and joining us for this Bike for Chai celebration. Kudos to everybody who have become riders and supporters of this incredible effort on behalf of Jewish people and those in need around the world. Have a fabulous Wednesday. We're heading up to Camp Simcha eventually, like everybody else here seems to be doing. Till then, Nachum Siegel reminding you, remember the past, live the present, and trust the future.